All right. Well, we are back, huh? We're back at the Nine Club Stop and Chat. This time we have a special guest. Mr. Chris Cobra Cole is with us.
Hey, I'm here.
How are you? How are you, dude?
I'm good. I'm hanging with you dudes.
Let me just start off by saying, you look fucking great. You look great.
Oh, thanks, man.
You got a nice haircut.
Dude, you got a nice haircut, bro. The beard's looking good. And that shirt, man. Whoa, I can't ignore that shirt you got on there either.
Look at this. Look at this.
You know, I've had this shirt in the closet for like a while now, and I've been like itching to wear it. So I'm stoked.
Oh, wow.
I finally get to.
So that's not a new one. It's an older one from back then.
No, it's from now, but it's been sitting in my closet for like a month, I think.
Been sitting on some info here.
So we've
been sitting on the info for a long time, actually.
Why sit on the info and not just divulge, hey, I'm back on Zero, everybody? Why now? Why wait?
Well, I mean, Dubs can answer that.
I think we all can answer it, but I don't know. I mean, go ahead. Sorry.
You got a plan for things like that. I mean, you want to have like product lined up so that like the drop is exciting, you know, and you want to like support it completely. And, you know, everybody lives in the future, which is actually my theory on why time flies. As you get older, it seems like the days fly by. Mm-hmm. And I think that it's just because we're always living ahead. We always segment our days and we segment our years, and we're looking ahead, especially when you do product development and design. Mm. You're living in the future, and you just can't wait for that thing to come out. So you're kind of just like the present just flies by waiting for that drop.
Would you say is so true, Chris? Because definitely. I lived my whole life not planning anything. I would just go out and skate and do my. Now I'm planning my day. I'm planning when I'm taking my nap. I'm planning when I'm filming. I'm like, I got my whole day planned. Because if it doesn't fall into place and I don't get that little nap, it's horrible.
Throws him off.
Well, yeah.
Dude, that nap is great.
It's crucial to my existence right now, man.
You actually like scheduling a nap, though. You do
100%.
That's so amazing.
But you don't sleep at night, right?
Excuse me?
Are you one of those dudes that like, stays up super late?
He's a nocturnal guy.
I am. But I have been getting better. You know, if I'm editing one night at maybe 3 in the morning. But, you know, last night I fell asleep at like 1.
That's good.
What time do you wake up?
9.
Set my alarm.
8 hours.
Yeah, 8 hours.
Solid.
Yeah,
solid.
That's good. Yeah. That's a good out. That's a good amount of hours.
I mean, yeah, right? You can't ask for more. That's great.
When you're shredding the curbs the way you shred the curbs, though, man, that's a lot of regeneration. You know, you really need that sleep.
Thank you for bringing that up, man, because I wanted to talk about this. How do you think? What do you think?
What
do you think about this?
We went from the Zero talk, not even getting into it, straight to the
I don't know. Let's not beat around the bush. We're going to get to this with the clips, man.
Yeah, I'm actually really excited on that. I've seen you flex on those curbs strong lately.
I appreciate that, man. We're just having fun, you know, just having fun and adding on to the tricks you already have, you know, stuff like that. It's cool.
I need to learn the tricks that you already have.
You pointed that really quick.
I need
quick,
to download going, those.
Come on, bro.
This guy can do anything.
You can do, you're slappier. Stop. You could slap
me. No, that's the funny thing. I can't slappy.
Really?
Because I, dude, you know how long it takes to like work in your trucks and they're all special and this is the way, like, because the way that you sit, I mean, as a human being, our weight goes into the back of our feet.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So like we're not perfectly balanced. So your trucks being a little bit peculiar and pulling to one direction to work with the way that you stand is specific. So they're not even straight really when you break them in, but they're straight for you when you stand on it that way. Right. And then the idea of just rolling up and smashing this shit out of my trucks onto a curb. Yeah. Oh, hell no. I need to set up another complete. We actually talked about that yesterday.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
Yeah. I could see that.
The curb complete?
That's right.
Yeah. Oh, I mean,
it really sells itself.
Oh, you were seriously talking about a curb board or just another board?
Oh, just like my my ride in my car. It would just sit there and it'd be extra wide and have these fatties on it.
You already ride a wide board. Are you going to make your curb board wider?
I mean, I ride an 8.5, which is like normal man size board.
You're talking to the wrong.
It depends on who
you're talking to the wrong crowd here.
But like, dude, that's real though.
I mean, last time I checked, we were all men, but we don't. Fuck.
No, I was just talking with you guys, knowing that you guys ride skinnier boards than that. It is becoming kind of like the standard.
I can't deny that. You're right.
You wouldn't dare see a bigger than an 8.5. In like the early 2000s, nobody was doing that.
No.
And now I go to the skate park and just average dudes are riding 8.6s and stuff.
That's insane.
It's insane.
Yeah. I mean, the last person I would really see like really riding a big would be Brian Anderson. He would ride the biggest board. And I was like, how the fuck are you riding that thing right now?
But he's a big dude.
So yeah. I got it. That's the thing. Yeah.
I remember seeing that too. Like, welcome to hell. You'd see his board and dude,
massive.
You'd be like, that dude's board is just like a man bench.
In production too, I'll be like, dude, this is the biggest board, and it would definitely be bigger than every other board that was.
And you would have production. The knuckle boards too, the big like toy machine where it had like the knuckle. And it looks even huger with that graphic.
Oh my god!
I love that graphic. That is just solid humor right there. three fingers and then like 10.
Oh yeah,
it's the best. It's probably one of the best graphics in skateboarding. Yeah. It'll live on forever. Right? Yeah. It'll live on.
I feel like that should be in a museum somewhere.
Totally.
Dude, yeah.
Like people were funny. You know, if like a time capsule, shoot that into space, like human beings were funny.
And they had a lot of fingers.
That's what they'd think.
Yeah.
We're not going there. We're not going there. That's
what,
you know.
What evolutionary benefit does this have? Having a big pincher.
They're passing it around like a meme. They're like, look at this. These people on this planet have 40 fingers.
Yeah, watch out for that Stockton slap.
Oh, anyway, bro, let's get back to the zero thing because first of all, congratulations.
Congratulations, yes, bro.
Back home, zero, fallen. It's like we went back in time. Like, where are you going to Wallenberg and treflipping that thing?
You don't need to do that again.
No, he doesn't need to do it. Oh.
I mean, like probably 60 goes into that. I figured out something that would make me do it quicker now, you know.
What's that?
You already ran through it.
Yeah, I already put in the hard work. I already dug the hole. So
what was the trick? What was the secret?
So it wasn't paved all rad at the top, right?
Mm.
And so right where you would take off for it, it had a slight dip, and then the top of the wedge was right there. So it dipped down and then go straight with. I mean, maybe it was a foot. Distance, so I was trying to pop before it.
Oh,
because I was like, dude, I'm not. Most of the time, I'll pop before the crack. If there's a crack, I'd rather just pop before it. Rincon has like a whole big block that's tilted down.
Yeah.
So when I skate Rincon, I pop before it.
Oh,
it makes more sense because it's just a straight drop. So I was doing that at Wallenberg forever. And then finally, I just decided I was just going to ride down the whoop and then tray flip off the end.
Off the very end, right.
And I landed in like 8 goes.
How many tries was the whole thing? I mean, you said 60, but obviously.
It was 68.
Wait, so on those tries that it shows that you're trying to land it, it's showing you popping earlier?
Before?
Yeah.
Oh, I got
it. I didn't even realize that.
Damn, then he took it like a little like kind of like. Little launch ramp, but not really because you're going down. But I, you know,
kind of. You're right. Yeah. There's a little bump action.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
Wow. Dude, just to pop before anything. That foot's a foot. You know.
Yeah,
well, but especially since Wallenberg, I think is like 17 feet or 19 feet or something. It's like super duper long.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Wait a minute, man. 68 tries, dude. How does your body even like, how do you even do that?
That clip was insane because of that. You kept falling over and over and over. You're like, dude, this guy's.
First of all, how old were you?
I was 23.
But still, that's a battle in itself. 68 times down that thing, bro.
Yeah. Wow. Oh, yeah. It wasn't cool. And you know what? I'm happy because I'm like, look what I've done in my life. but I can't remember most of the things I've done in my life because of the things that I've done in my life.
That's amazing. So like,
I need to have people around to be like, hey, remember that time that you did this thing? Because the memory is probably somewhere floating around, but it's like the filing cabinet's been pushed over, and I just need somebody to point in a direction, and I can find the file, and I'll go, here it is, and I remember the thing.
Clarify this for me. Please clarify this. Yeah. Shit.
The most embarrassing thing that ever happened to me, Chris, was I needed a clip for a video. I don't even remember what video it was. I don't remember, and I said, oh, wait, I have this clip at the beach. I have a clip. I called Ty, and I said, Ty, you have that clip of me doing a 5-0 grind heel flip shove out. And he was like, yeah, that was in Yeah Right. And I was like, oh, sorry. I gotta go. It was the most embarrassing. Like, I had no idea.
You didn't even remember.
I didn't even remember what it was. I thought it was never used. That's embarrassing. Calling the filmer and the filmmaker to get the clip that was in his.
That's impressive, Chris. Yeah.
I feel you on that, though. Because there's definitely been times where I've shown up to spots and been like, dude, this spot's rad. It'd be sick if somebody did this. And then my friend Ian was like, you did that.
You did that.
You did that.
When you forget like that, that's amazing, dude. That's just the arsenal of tricks that you've done. Bro, it's so amazing.
It happens.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, I don't know if it's, like, you don't know if you're, like, patting yourself on the back or whether you should, like, I don't know, start, like, eating like ginseng and
ginkgo biloba.
That's a good segment for him.
Yeah.
Did you do this trick?
Keep that memory strong.
Straight up.
Yeah.
I'm going to order some ginkgo biloba for you on Amazon.
Yeah, that.
That's the stuff.
Ginkgo biloba.
Yeah.
Yeah.
68 tries down Wallenberg, bro. That is a feat.
Fuck yeah.
That is a
feat. But then to actually figure out like what I'm going to go about it this way now. I'm going to try it this way. And then in 8 tries, boom.
But that's how, I mean, that happens a lot in skating when you're battling a trick. But to do it on that obstacle must have been unreal.
Because that happens. And then to change it up like that too.
Totally.
Yeah. Changing it up and the fine tuning, I think, is why we all really got into skating and why we all like it. Mm-hmm. And a lot of us have that in a lot of other places in our life, like we have that engineering brain, and it's like science, right? Like you have a hypothesis and you test out the test, you gather the information, you alter the test, you test it again, gather that information against the other information, keep it going. And that's what we all really liked about skating.
Yeah. You know?
That's what we still love doing.
So hard to do when you're just emotionally distraught trying a trick, though, is trying to figure
that's
out.
Right.
Because then you, I tried that. No, that didn't work. I tried that. No, that didn't work. It's tough. It's a battle.
Then it becomes a real poisonous moment. And I've found this in my own life where your brain's an asshole, man. It really is. And when you're battling to that degree, your brain starts self-talking, and it's like putting like a drop of black dye into the wash. Right.
Yeah.
And it just starts going into like, this is why these things don't work out in my life. And you start analyzing all these other parts of your life. And at that point, I know now to just call it.
You're like, done.
Totally.
I'm done. Like,
right.
Once I start thinking about other things in my life and analyzing and kind of going down like a depression spiral
totally.
In the middle of a trick.
Oh yeah.
I know it's not the trick. This is
beyond
this is my brain being an asshole and I need to back.
He's like, that's when I lost. Like, I'm thinking way too much right now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Where you're like, how do I get out of this?
That happens a lot in skating.
For sure.
That's why we're mental.
See, Chris, here's the thing, though, is like I get that to that point, but then I still feel bad because I've already wasted the, 2 hours of this filmer's time. And I'm like, okay, I got to just for his. Now I'm doing it for him rather than for me. You know,
I can't deny that,
you know,
dude, I feel you so hard on that.
Oh.
I remember, I would always try to make sure that I got my trick as much as I possibly could. And I remember the first couple times that I went out and didn't make the tricks, and I was like tripping, like properly tripping.
this dude that hates me. Yeah. He's never going to want to film with me again.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, meanwhile, he has like an arsenal of fucking clips like this. Like, come on. Give me a break. Give me a break. Please.
Well, I think it's because I'm such a bad filmer as a dude, because if you're not trying the trick,
you're over it.
I'm the worst filmer. I'm like, fuck this. Because being on one knee is me trying a trick. That hurts.
And bending
kneeling down and and trying to get that angle. And then if they like just kind of kick it out, I'm just like, all right, you call me when you're ready.
No, I feel that, man. I feel like as a skater, I have all the patience in the world to try to get the trick. But if it's somebody else, I have no patience for filming. None.
Really?
None.
Totally.
Hate
Come
it.
On.
Totally.
What about Beeble's Park? That was the whole process.
It was fun. It's a process.
In the moment.
It's a moment. Yeah. And we film each other, you know? So you're going to film, you're going to put in that work, but it sucks.
Yeah.
Yeah. So gather Chris Cole's never going to film me.
You know,
it's a possibility.
Maybe I'll learn patience.
Slappies?
That sounds like it'd be good for my life.
You probably teach him how to slappy and he can film you.
Oh, there you go.
There you go.
I could. I'll give Chris Cole a slappy lesson. How about that?
Yeah. Like how is your teaching method? Are you good?
It's good. You
small
just
small breakdowns.
You do a little S curve and you bash into it.
It's pretty good.
Oh, S like.
So
like
say you're going to do a switch
curve, like from an angle, like
carve into that
bolt.
Thing.
Carve into it. So like if you're going to do a front crook or a switch front crook, right? You would take this little. You know, you start off this way and you kind of curve around and then like that, you know, so you do a little S.
Are you running parallel?
No.
Mm-mm. So you're going kind of slightly 45 degree angle at it?
Crooked grinds, yes, you're riding parallel, but still a little bit of a curve. You got to get that curve because you need that heel toe in the pocket action.
Yeah, throw you right in there comfortably.
So you're regular. So you...
Nice.
You
good memory.
Thank you, bro. So for a crooked grind, you just literally just come a little bit of an angle and then pop that toe down, that front toe.
I got the crooked grind.
Well, what else do you want to know?
I do have that. I think it's just how much you flex on it. You know, it's like I can do the crook, but I can't do like a switch front crook. I'm not twisting around into like back five from that. I'm not doing any of that stuff.
And popping over the opposite side.
You got to really practice these things, you know? It's not just going to, some people have it naturally like that.
Well, we just go down there all the time. So that's, you know, I'm just like, that's my spot, you know?
How do you deal with all the people, though? There's a million people.
It's the beach. You know what, Chris? I've been skating there my whole life. So I'm just kind of, I hate it, but it's still like, for me, it's almost like I'm skating there, you know, in the 90s, late 90s again, you know, it's like, that's where I grew up. So it's kind of rad in that sense.
Oh man. I like a empty warehousing district on the weekend. That's more my speed.
Yes. Yeah.
You know, what's awesome is that we've gone from zero to curb talk twice today.
I know.
It's curbs are so fun.
They're fun.
You know,
they're so fun.
But what happened? What's up with zero, dude? That's what
Let's go back to the point about curbs.
Go ahead.
So, about curbs, I've like kicked around the idea of doing a curb part for years. And doing tricks on a curb is about as hard as a ledge.
Yeah.
Dude, I was
like real moves, kickflip back nose blocks and stuff.
And
that's hard.
Let me tell you something though. It's so much more frustrating than a ledge because it's literally it's this high. So that's what's frustrating about it is like you're trying this trick and you're like, dude, and then when you get bodied, when you get slammed on that thing, you're like, this little 3-inch, 4-inch thing just took me out.
That's happened.
It happens to us all. Imagine like a fakie 5-0 slam on a curb, like pop into a fakie, because you know that fakie 5 slam is next level.
Oh yeah.
It's pick you up and huck you out like Jazzy Jeff.
Later. Yeah, out of the Fresh Prince getting thrown out. Yeah.
Yeah.
Straight up.
Oh, great reference.
That is.
DJ Jazzy Jeff.
But you know who's good at the curb top or the good curb tricks is Ryan Gallant.
He's a dude.
You know, like doing tricks into him.
See, that's a whole different thing though. I don't pop. I just rather
He's over that. He's moved on.
I just rather bash and do combos.
what a departure from your previous style, which was, you know, hopping up to things.
I mean, I've departed.
I have. Just graduated.
You just find stuff that you're into, you know, and right now I'm into it. It's so fun to learn and retrain my brain to not ollie.
You're like a caterpillar. You're like, you did one thing, you stopped for a while, and then you cocooned, and then you went cocooned into a butterfly.
And he curves right into it like a caterpillar.
S curve. Just like a caterpillar.
He's taking his final form.
Yeah.
Is that your little dog? Good. I was wondering if you had a little dog or a hamster over there. It's all a little squeaky.
Dude, a hamster. What the hell?
I don't know. I had a hamster growing up named Bubba.
Yeah, that's a good name.
It's a good name.
That's definitely not like the name that you were, you know, you didn't put a lot of effort into it.
Yeah, I mean, Larry, I was
probably like three.
Like Bubba and Larry are way, like he put more thought into Larry.
Of course.
Than Bubba.
For sure. That's funny.
Yeah, yeah.
I fucking call my son Bubba.
Do you? I call my cat Bub.
Dude, it's so crazy because a lot of people call their son Bubba.
Bubba.
It's so random. Really?
Do you say like Bub though?
My Bubba, Bubba, come here real quick. You know,
I come in, I go, hey Bub, yeah. I call my cat Bub.
It's so random like how we have these little names for our cats and our sons or daughters. Yeah.
I'm glad that I call my cat the same thing you call your son.
It's so Bubba. Random. So random.
Well, it's like a little, it's kind of, there's something about it that's like endearing as like a pet name.
Totally.
You know, for your kid, like to just like, it's an endearing sort of like
totally is.
Calling, mm-hmm. like calling a kid buddy.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It's got this, it's got this wholesome feel, right?
Yeah.
But it's funny that we do nickname things that have proper names, like more than enough names, but then we nickname them anyway. Like we're just so name greedy. I got all these names building up inside of me. I need them out.
I need to use these things.
I like nicknames. Yeah. I think it's a cool, I think some skaters need nicknames.
We all got them.
I know. Dubs, Krob.
Hell yeah.
K-Fatty.
Kel-Rel.
I got a few Beans.
Got a couple of them in.
Cobra. Like, I mean,
Cobra.
Come on.
Cobra.
Yeah, that's a working title. definitely need the nickname. Definitely need the nickname. You know,
I think it helps.
Maybe you're Australian too. They nickname everything.
That's true.
Yeah. They actually make longer names to shorten your name.
I need an example.
I know. I don't know. I'm trying to think of one.
I was just trying to be like, wait,
can we phone a friend?
We don't have that. I love capability. That.
That's a new addition there.
Yeah, but like McDonald's is Macca's.
Macca's.
Yeah, you're right. Sandwich is a sandwich is a Zanga.
Zanga? I need to get a Zanga.
Zanga. Bologna Zanga.
Like sunglasses or Sunnies?
Sunnies.
Okay, true. I can see that.
Yeah, yeah.
PB&J Zanga.
He's got something here.
What about the bathroom? Toilet.
The pissa.
The pissa.
Isn't that like more of like...
What is that?
That's English.
It was, but I'll take it.
Is that your dog though? Is that the little dog? What is he doing over there?
Yeah. Being annoying.
He's got a little squeaky. Nice. He's got a little squeaky toy.
Yeah, he's rad.
Playing with his little bone.
Yeah, I don't know why he's decided to squeak things at this current moment.
Animals are funny though, because anytime I'm doing something, Larry just wants my attention. But when I'm not doing anything, she could care less. She's just off in the corner, like whatever.
Wait, hold on. So Larry is your female dog?
Cat. Yeah, female.
I like your style.
Thank you, bro.
This cat is very interactive. Bro.
If it were bigger, would it kill you?
She loves
like just randomly, like when you walked in your house, if it were like big, like mountain lion big, would it just hunt you for sport, you think?
Funny that you bring that up. I sometimes sense the anger in her, you know, like if I'm home late and she's hungry, you know, she'll just stand over there and just give me the eye, you know?
Yeah.
However, though, I thought it was very interesting. I grew up with cats, right? And cats, they play fight, you know, and when I first brought Larry home as a kitten, I was play fighting and, you know, with my hands, she would use her claw, you know, she'd put a little claw on there, you know? And then as I would bring my face up to her and she would retract the claw and just use her paw on my face. And I was thinking, I'm like, wow, that is really amazing that a little kitten has the you know, the wherewithal awareness to not use the claw in the face.
Wow.
Yeah.
Nice little soft paw.
Little
your
soft
face.
Paw.
I love that.
Isn't that amazing?
I'm going to do awesome. That more often. We're going to play more often.
Little soft paw.
You're like, I talk with this.
Yeah. Yeah.
This is how I communicate. Don't cut this.
Don't. I don't need no scratches on me.
That's amazing. Don't do that. Actually, you would have looked super cool, though, with like a Tomax Zamot guard on the face.
Well, what?
It's like pretty tight.
Tomac
G.I. Joe reference.
Oh, G.I. Joe.
That is.
Zamot. Scar down the.
Oh, that's right.
Yes.
The two twins.
I think that's before your time, Kelly.
Yeah.
G.I. Joe.
G.I. Joe is like, right. I saw it, but I didn't know it too well. Yeah. You know?
Yeah, we had right on the cusp there.
Tight.
I always saw those cartoons they made late, or they made some like, if you look back, they're pretty crazy, right? Like the
G.I. Joe cartoons.
Yeah,
I mean, a lot of cartoons in hindsight that you look at are definitely a little
G.I. Joe's aren't. G.I. Joe's are really like solid. They're
well, they made funny ones. I think they dubbed over voices and like did that. There was a thing that happened.
Oh, you're talking about E-Bomb's World.
Yeah, okay.
that okay, then that might have thrown you off for sure.
That's exactly what it was.
Kelly's like, what is this G.I. Joe thing?
No, I know G.I. Joe. I remember the action figures. I just never really watched it. But like later on, way down the line, I was like, what are these G.I. Joe videos surfacing? And they were the E-Bombs World stuff.
That's what it was.
They're
so funny. Voiceover. They're so damn funny. Yeah, every time I talk to like my bestie on the phone, one of us will pick up and say, oh, hell no, what's up, dog? And that's from that E-Bombs World.
That's so crazy.
And we've been doing it for years and years now.
It stuck with you.
E-Bombs World.
Is that still around? Shit.
I think that you have to just YouTube it at this point.
Yeah, yeah.
That's something that came, that was before its time, in a sense of like, if that was out now, that would be like a multi-million dollar like company.
Kind of like World Star in a way, right?
Yeah.
Somewhat? Is that kind of?
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
Like an aggregate for funny stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know? They would have had their own champagne or something like that. All sorts of influencer deals going.
Exactly. Like fuck Jerry. Yeah.
There you go.
Like exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah.
That's the new American dream right there. You used to be like, get down here and like work your ass off, have your own shop, provide a better life for your kids. Now it's like, be an aggregate for funny stuff, create a couple good memes, branch off into these other.
Yeah, then you done did it.
And, totally.
You know, have a poppin' YouTube channel and.
Dude, it's so bizarre, but yeah, you hit the nail.
Yeah, that's
it. I mean, if there's a way to make a living at things, people are going to go do it.
Totally. YouTube, I'm just jealous.
I know.
And try to do it their best.
Speaking of making a living, let's get into the zero thing now.
Yeah.
Zero skateboards, dude.
Yes.
Yeah.
Let's talk about this. You said you were working with probably Jamie for like over a month on this, and literally
a year.
No, a year. Wow.
Probably somewhere around that.
Okay.
Probably like somewhere in the 6 month to a year zone.
So if you were doing it 6 months to a year and you wouldn't wear zero stuff, you wouldn't skate zero stuff. Cause like you said before, like you've been itching to put that shirt on. That must be a little bit of a, just like, oh God, this is happening. I just want to like.
Yeah, it's tough.
Yeah.
Like it's tough mentally when you know the next thing and you're excited about it. And you can't fully embrace the next thing that you're excited about because mm-hmm. you have timelines and guidelines, you know, you're just, it's a secret and you really do want the secret to stay. So to shoot the ad, here I am on this board, but every time I would go out to shoot a photo, I'd have the board, and then if skaters would show up to a spot, it's like that board's got to go back in the car, and I need to have another complete ready, which I never did. So I always had to like switch my boards all the time. And if I just skated the spot last night, and I'm going out skating again tomorrow or like today, but I got to warm up at a skate park. Well, I got to change my board out.
Mm.
To this spray painted board.
Right.
And then once I get to the spot, put that board back on.
What a production.
That's a it's a production.
Yeah.
Oh, something that I'm not a big fan of setting up boards, you know, maybe when I was younger, but now it's just kind of like I just want to get it done and over with, you know. I'm not really, I don't take time.
Yeah. It's not easy. It's just not that fun when you're all stoked out.
Yeah.
Trying to like get after it, especially after you warm up and then you're like, okay, let's warm. You always pick the skate park that's close to the spot, or the spot to warm up that's close to the spot.
Sure.
And so here you are at the spot, changing your board, warmed up, getting less and less warmed up.
Here's a thought. I mean, you should have came to me when you were shooting your ad, but green screen board. You could have just been skating a green board and then they shoot the photo and you just superimpose the image.
Wow.
In there.
That's some next level shit there, Chris.
I'm telling you.
Yeah, right style, right?
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's why they pay you the big bucks, man.
Smart thinking. Damn right.
Smart thinking right there. You know, having the bold under my feet, though, was a motivator. When I would drop that thing and see it as you see that nose drop in front of you, you're stoked.
Let's take a timeline real quick. You went from zero to plan B, right?
Zero to nothing for a while.
Okay. He did his own board for a while, right?
Oh, you did your own little drops.
Yeah. I did a blackout board. Yeah, we made this blackout board that was just tiger stripes and it's black on black. And we made 666 of them.
Nice. They probably sold out in a minute.
Real on the nose, you know?
So that doesn't, you know, that's cool. That doesn't really, but so you've zero, and then what's a point in time where you were on zero and now you're back on zero? What, how many years was that gap?
I don't even know.
You don't even know?
You know, I should know, but the file somewhere.
14, like, Raj? Maybe no. Raj saying 14 kid, yeah. years?
No, so that, okay.
This, there you go.
That's the story. So I have magazines right here. Check this out.
Okay,
so I'm right next to my bookcase, right next to my bookcase. And so my zero ad is shot on the tube rail. And this is the tube rail from the Thrasher cover.
Okay.
Is it the Barcelona spot?
No, it's out here in Cali.
Oh, okay. I was like, wait, what's that?
But I went and shot this photo for the Skater of the Year mag. Right before my son was born. And it was kind of like me flying out to California to put on the heat for my family.
I remember you talking about this in your episode. Yeah. Yeah.
So I went out and I got that photo and it meant a lot to me. And so for this ad meaning a lot to me, I went back 14 years later to the same spot to get a photo on that same.
Wow.
That's sick.
So that's the 14 year gap.
That's the 14 year gap. There's a man who I love very much in my life who didn't exist when that photo was taken.
Right.
And now he's 14.
He's 14.
He's running around.
That's so sick.
So maybe the zero gap to gap, gap to gap, is
it's like 4 years, 5 years.
Something. Oh, that's it. Okay, 4 or 5 years.
We were saying 2014 maybe is when you left. Is that sound about right?
Oh, that sounds about right.
Okay.
Something around there maybe.
Still, it's a long time. Like you're saying, you get older, the time flies.
That's right. You get busy.
Yeah, that's true.
Even when you're not busy.
Yeah.
I get a lot of kudos for being more busy than I am. I am busy. But you know what? Maybe I should... maybe they're like, whoa, you're probably so busy. And I'm like looking around going, I got to get to work.
I should be. I should be.
I should be doing. You're right. You're right.
Is that 6 years that long ago? Does it feel that long ago?
Not at all.
Right.
I mean, yeah, it feels just long enough that when Jamie and I started working on graphics and stuff again, it was just like, you know, hair stands up on your arms because you remember
right back in it,
how good we are at it together.
Right.
Like the way that we can like feed off each other and come to like this feels right.
That's dope.
It was pretty crazy.
That's super shit.
Yeah.
And so how long were you on Zero from the beginning to the first time that you got off?
Giving him a quiz right now.
I know, man.
That's like when Zero started, right?
Was it when Zero started?
No, it wasn't when Zero started. I felt like a kid when Zero started.
Yeah.
Because I remember when Zero stuff came into the skate shop for the first time in Philly. And we were so pumped because Thrill of It All just came out.
Yes.
And my friend and artist, Ryan Beck, actually, I didn't have money to buy things, right? And he bought me the American Zero shirt.
Mm. Wait, wasn't it, what's it called? Welcome to Hell. Isn't that kind of when it came out, though?
It was after, right?
Well, because it started.
American Zero.
So Zero was a clothing company.
Yeah.
That Jamie started, and there was a commercial in Welcome to Hell for Zero, which was the clothing company. Mm-hmm. And then it became the board company after that. And when Thrill of It All came out, it was completely different. I was seeing these blue collared dudes, not these fine polished technicians, but dudes like the guys that I skated with. And they were out there and they were putting it down. They were going for it, but they were also putting slams in their part, which like I had never seen somebody do, just dropping on a dumpster and eat shit on a bench. And that was part of the part.
Yeah.
I was like, this is the best.
Right.
Dude. And I even with all my baggy gear and stuff, we were going around and dropping it on dumpsters left and right.
Yeah. I'll say like, even like loving like the whole like baggy pants thing myself, I always related myself to Adrian Lopez for some reason. I always thought, because he skated like ledges. Bridge. Yeah, he like skated ledges, did dope flip tricks, backside flips. Like
definitely.
Wore baggy gear.
Yeah, totally. It was sick.
You know, he was just like an originalist. He didn't need to fit any sort of like mold. Still doesn't.
Yeah.
But doesn't need to fit in some mold where it's like, mm-hmm. oh, if you run baggy stuff, then you're this type of dude.
Right.
He just blended his own thing.
Yeah, it was funny. And I never even thought about
people
that.
People love him.
Oh, hell dude.
Because so he's sick. Because he's a legend, great, huh? But he's also, his fan base was like giant. You know how P-Rod has like a fan base,
yeah.
right?
Oh, yeah.
Before P-Rod was Adrian Lopez.
No, Adrian like, definitely did.
Oh, sure. Yeah. I was a fan of him. Yeah. But it's funny, I never really thought about the baggy thing and the Zero thing. I just kind of accepted it for what it was. I never really even thought about that.
Well, also like, I mean, if you watch Thrill of It All, like Ellington's wearing baggy pants and Copelman's wearing baggy pants.
True.
Jamie's wearing
that's
baggy
true.
Pants.
Yeah.
They're all wearing baggy pants because that's just like what you did.
But he stuck with it.
Yeah, that was at the time.
Like, yeah, he stuck with it.
You know what tripped me out? I think what stuck out a lot was, I think it was Wade Burkett. Never when he freaking does the pole jam. Is that what him?
Dude, yes, it is.
That was in, I remember watching that video, like, whoa, that's some gnarly, gnarly shit right there.
Dude, it's a full on like traffic sign post bent over. It's not a small post to not have you drive into 7-Eleven.
Yeah,
window.
Yeah.
It's a pole and it's tilted like he's balanced on it. He's keeping balance, grinding up it all the way down on it. It's woof.
That was awesome.
It's heavy enough that I drive past that parking lot.
Really?
All the time. And when somebody pointed it out, like I think Jamie was like, that's where the Burkett pole jam was. I'm like, dude, I fan out. Just knowing that it was there.
That's it.
That's so cool, man. That's awesome.
So working on graphics with Jamie, I mean, man, it's like you guys just got back together and just, you didn't miss a beat.
Yeah. It's, you know, it's also good because it, just like, you know, any relationships, it's your time apart is it, you both individually grow and the world moves, you kind of like sharpen the knife of your own skill sets and things like that. And then when you get back into the swing of things, both of you are sharper.
Totally.
And so it actually works out really well.
Oh, it's amazing.
Super sick.
Plus, I mean, it happened like super organic, which it wasn't a you know, it would make the most business sense right now. It wasn't one of those. Right. It was I was skating with these dudes. These guys are my friends, and I like skating with them. And this is a brand that I'll always love. That now I'm like part of the team, but I'm not part of the team.
Right.
It was it like at a certain point, it was like starting to feel weird almost. Mm. And I'm sure it looked weird too. It's like skating with Dane every day.
Yeah.
People are like, so what's up with that?
What's going on? Yeah. Well, it's just rad, man. Like we were saying in the beginning, just a zero and then fall in again. And yeah, full circle, man.
It just makes sense. People saw that, it brought them back. Like I remember hitting you up to do this. Like, hey, you want to do the stop and chat thing? You're like, cool. Next day, I'm like, oh my God, that's insane.
Yeah.
It made me so happy. I'm like, that makes sense, dude. You know?
You didn't even know prior that that was whole. That's it's all about the energy, bro.
I know.
You know? Like, well, that's how shit happens right there, bro.
I know that talking to about skateboarding with Chris Cole is one of the funnest things to do.
Oh my God, it's great.
Because the way you look at it and the way you describe everything is so good and it's fun. But just the fact the fact that, you know, everyone in skateboarding saw you were back on zero really was super stoked. Everybody. Mm-hmm. I could, you know, just... We're all fans.
So. Like, they were stoked more than if you just went to some other random company. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
like,
that's
totally. There was one itch that needed scratching, and there was only one thing that would scratch it. And I knew that forever.
Right.
It was just making sure that was the right move. And, you know, emotionally, yes, it totally is. And it's like, could you go to something else? Yes. Could you start your own thing? Yes. But go to something else and people want you on zero.
Yeah.
Start something else. People want you on zero.
Totally.
And then in your heart, you know, you would just make another zero. It just wouldn't be called zero and you would want it to be called zero.
Yeah.
And you would want to have this shirt on.
Yeah. You could call it American Zero.
Call it 02.
Yeah, American Zero.
Dude, it just wouldn't be the same because it's like the people involved, everything about it's just like that's home.
No, totally, that's man. Awesome, like I said, like Kelly said, we're all super stoked for you, man. And we just seeing was like, oh my God, that's amazing.
I'll say too,
it's
like
hard to keep a secret.
No.
Yeah, I bet that was hard, but I think seeing you added on back on there and then seeing, like, I'm a huge fan of Dylan Jabe. And seeing him a part of Zero too. So I'm like, cool, you got this, all this energy coming with you guys. I'm like, there we go.
Yeah.
You know, awesome. What's tricky. What's funny about Dylan is Dylan rips. Like Dylan really rips.
Yeah.
But he rips in my lane. And so it's like, it's really bizarre. Like I came back in and there's like a dude in my seat.
Right.
You know, like I'm not a tech guy, you know, I'm not like a Shane O'Neill, right? I'm not that level tech. You know, the P-Rods and the Shane O'Neills are like, they're next level with the technical abilities. And I liked to find my own sort of blend of this, of precision while also like doing a bit of gutsy stuff, but not too gutsy, not like super huge stuff. I wasn't grinding the longest rails ever.
Right.
You know, I would rather skate a 9 and do something really hard on it than grind something huge. But saying that makes me want to grind something huge, you know? And now, like, so I was Zero's tech guy.
Right,
like it's kind of neat that there's another Zero tech guy.
Yeah,
so totally we can like hang out and be tech.
Dude, he rips.
You know what's really funny about it though is the dudes can do tricks. Like they're known for being like zero or die. Dane can do every trick.
Yeah, Dane's really good.
He can do every trick.
Totally.
You should indulge. I think right now is the time to indulge. If you got some shit that you want to try that's so weird that you think in your mind, fucking do it.
Yeah.
Straight up.
I agree.
Absolutely.
No holds bar. No holds bar, Dane. Like, just go for it, bro. Just do whatever you can do. Because everyone's going to fucking really admire it regardless.
Yeah.
Totally. He's like, I don't like the way I look when I do it or some shit like that.
Oh, no. He's so fun to watch, man. He's so talented.
I know. He really is, man.
I know.
The minds of skateboarders.
Man. So Zero video coming soon.
I don't know.
Oh.
Well, you got
Is there a Zero video coming soon?
Yeah. That's what we're... We had is, you on the show. It's next month. Do you have enough footage?
You didn't know.
No.
Yeah.
There's a Zero something, I think. It's not. I don't know.
He has to hold all these secrets. He had to hold.
I know.
Don't even ask him. Don't ask him.
Pull anything out of him, man.
Especially when he starts swerving on the answers. Like, just leave it alone.
There's a zero. Yeah, the zero thing. Yeah.
Dude, are you saying I'm a bad liar?
Now you held it for a year, so it's pretty good.
I know that's pretty damn good.
You know, it's tricky to not give a definitive answer to like my kid. Because, you know, he skates. Yeah. All of his friends skate.
Right.
And you're like, you know, I might do something, but.
Oh, you couldn't even tell your son that.
That's amazing.
Dude, high school.
Secrets are real as shit right
How
now.
How is dad not telling his own kid? Man, that's tough, bro.
Yeah. Yeah.
Especially you have that Zero shirt in the closet. He comes in there, dad, what's this? What's a Zero shirt I found?
Yeah, it takes it.
Going out on a day-to-day basis, coming home with clips and like son's asking you like how'd your day go and
you're board's different
like,
from 2 hours ago.
You're not getting boards sent to your house, that's for sure. You know, no Zero boxes can show up.
I live right down the street.
There you go.
I took them up. No, like, I mean, eventually there had to be like a moment where it was like, okay, this is happening. You tell anybody, I'll kill you.
Yeah, yeah, right.
Had to be one of those moments because it's like the backseat's loaded with Zero bolts.
Right.
Like, well, skated, not skated, put back on, you know.
Well, we talked about this before in the other episode, but you're probably the one of the first tricks I remember being leaked through YouTube when you back three the love gap.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, you don't want that happening anymore. You gotta that's how he learned to keep his secrets, is that.
Well, no, somebody else was filming, right? Somebody else was filming and then uploaded it to YouTube.
Yeah.
YouTube. And it was just, I don't know.
The secret squirrel.
Remember that time that Nyjah posted his ass on Instagram?
Oh, did he?
I can't remember. No. That's cool that
did you take a screenshot of that, Kelly?
stop being so hetero. I don't remember that. I didn't see that.
I literally don't remember that. And if I did, I would.
The only ass I see on
Kelly would tell you. Yeah. The archive is real.
The only ass I see on Instagram is Nick Dompierre.
Oh, yeah.
Like this. I'm like, oh, Nick, dude. What the fuck is going on? Come on.
I can't deny it.
Yeah, it was like for 2 seconds, it was just like a joke, right? And it was 2 seconds, and I swear to God, the entire world screen grabbed it. It was like every single person was on stories at that moment. It was seriously up for not even 2 minutes.
Oh, wow.
And I got texted it.
Oh, so it was an accidental ass post.
No, it was like, it was just funny. Like he posted it laughing with his friends and pulled it down instantly. But by that point, everybody had screen grabbed
it.
I came across it. Somehow I was on Instagram at that moment. I came across it at the same exact time. That's how the back three was. It was like, for some reason, everybody was on YouTube at that same time and like was searching for
Chris Goldfoot.
Back three. Yeah.
Possible leaked back three.
So wait a minute. So it gets leaked on YouTube. Did it stay up on YouTube or did somebody have to take that down? Do we know who posted it?
It was this one kid. I forget his name now. Okay. But it was like the name was etched in like everybody's memory. Like dudes were giving them like death threats and stuff.
Oh, jeez.
Like not my dudes.
No.
And I'm sure they weren't real death threats. They weren't like Adrian Lopez fan death threats. They were, these were just like, fuck you, kid. You know, like.
So he took it down.
Fucking shit up.
Yeah, he took it down.
He took it down. I mean, come on. Back then, too, it's like these videos are so secretive, you know?
Yeah.
It's like you film for 4 years and nobody's even seeing footage of you, you know? You're filming for this shit. And then all of a sudden, it's leaked.
And you're not seeing footage of you either. That's actually exactly that's a help and a hindrance to go out and just keep your head down and keep chipping away, keep chipping away, keep chipping away, and then load up the timeline and see where the holes are, mm-hmm. or be like, there's too many gaps. That I didn't turn front side one time, you know, things like
that. For sure. Yeah. Yeah. It's a trip, man.
Trying
it's
to shape and mold your part and make sure it fits, you know, what you're trying to create. Yeah,
totally. That's when, if you get a song rights denied at that point, it hurts. Yeah, that one hurts because the timeline's all laid out.
Yeah, definitely. Like,
it takes a while for you to emotionally let go of how that cadence was going to roll. Mm-hmm. Oh,
because you got to re-edit it, put a new song to it. It's a whole new part.
Yeah.
It's a whole new part.
Totally.
Wait, what part is that? Is there a certain part that happened to you that hurt you the most emotionally, like song-wise?
Yeah, my 401.
Whoa. What issue is it?
I already know. Issue 40.
Issue... This fucking guy, Chris.
So you didn't type the common. I knew the common song. It's the light. You didn't want that song?
No.
But the funny thing is, that was like my introduction to common was that. And I was like, that song is dope. Yeah.
You're amazing, dude. Again, because the archive and the memory is fuck.
Chris Cole.
I remember just being in 401 and, dude, we didn't really have options on songs, and they would just put a fucking song, whatever they actually had, you know, the rights to put on, that's what they would put on. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I feel you on that. I definitely feel you on that, because that's definitely not something that I would have chosen for myself. Mm-hmm. So, you know.
Wait, so what song did you want?
Yeah. They heard that I have a very eclectic and bizarre taste of music, and I wanted to skate to Debbie Gibson, Lost in Your Eyes.
Oh my God. No way. Amazing.
Yeah. Because I was just like, that song goes, right? That song kills it. It still kills it.
It does.
Rules. But they were just like, dude, no. Like, there's no way. But they were like, he likes love songs. We'll give him this other love song, thinking that they're all created equal. And not the common song isn't bad.
Right.
Yeah.
But it's not me.
It's not what you envisioned.
Yeah. And yeah, I would have definitely chosen Chicago. Like, you're the inspiration after that, or like, I don't know.
What about Credence?
Credence is awesome.
That would have been a whole different lane right there. That's I didn't know that. That's pretty cool. You didn't want that song.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I didn't want mine either. So. And
what for what
I don't even remember what the song is, but that's what I'm saying. You didn't have a choice. Yeah. So it's just like, I'm honored to be in the video. Yeah. Fucking throw whatever you know, I think at that time, I didn't even know if I even had a choice.
Right. No, you know I don't. Saying? I had a 4-in-1 section too, and I didn't have any choice.
Yeah,
at all.
It was just like, you roll with the format. This is what they're giving you. Yeah. You know,
because they had access to like their library.
This is what they had access to. Yeah. Exactly.
Well, I mean, this is issue 40 by that point. So I don't know if that's why I thought I had a choice, or maybe I just threw it in there like, hey, I want to skate to this, and they're just like, fuck you, kid. that was probably like the one that I was
that stung.
But I did want to skate to actually I wanted to skate to Weezer for In Bloom.
No way.
And we couldn't get the rights to Weezer.
What song?
It was too expensive. Falling for You.
I don't know that one off the top of my head.
It's off of Pinkerton, which is the best album.
Undone Sweater.
No, Sweater. That's Blue Album.
Pinkerton.
I don't know.
Pinkerton's is their sophomore album. It was their second album. It was like the one that
I like that's
different and sick.
Okay.
I like the song you skated to In Bloom. I thought it fit really good because it fit with like the actual skating. You know what I mean? Mm.
It was really good. I that was like the happy second choice. And so I was like really into it. And also I grew up listening to the Misfits and to Danzig, because my brother was obsessed with Misfits and Danzig and Sam Hain and stuff.
And so
I listened to that stuff all growing up.
And that's right when you got on Zero, pretty much, isn't it?
That was...
Because you were riding in Joy boards, and I swore it was like you were circa, and then like I think some Zero boards were in that.
I don't know if there were any Zero boards in that part, but that was definitely, you can see my transition to where I'm going where I'm realizing, like, from dumb kid who wears what he has access to I can wear things on the outside about how I think and feel on the inside. Like, I start to make that transition in that part. And you can see it, because there's like circa shirts that I'm wearing are a little bit more heavy metal. Like, if they had a logo that had a skull on it, I was about that. Yeah. And I would start to wear like wrist cuffs and stuff.
Yeah.
It's all in that part.
The funny thing is to the outside world, it looks like it's just overnight. It looks like a switch, you know. But I'm sure it was a span
totally.
And yeah, it's definitely a span of some time for sure.
It's a span of some time. And, you know, nowadays people just like delete all the photos on their Instagram and then they come back all fashioned out. And now they're like stylish and fashion.
Oh,
like,
wait a minute.
You forget about that other shit you saw.
Yeah.
So true. We got
some Like, weren't you just the dork?
Check this shit out.
I feel like we could, as skate fans, listen to the Dubs talk about old videos and forum.
Oh my god!
For
days.
This entire episode.
Fuck, being a part of the whole beginning of that shit is pretty mind blowing. But it evolved into something legendary.
Yeah, it did. My first video that I ever bought from a skate shop was 411 number one.
Oh wow!
Yeah, like I had like a skate TV taped off of Nickelodeon as a kid and stuff like that.
That's some shit right there.
Dude, so tight. Yeah, like, if you watch old skate TVs now, so tight.
Yeah, it's still.
What was on skate TV?
Fuck, I think that was the first time I saw like Guy and like, it was just like a whole like era that I mean I even wanted to go, and there was an opportunity for me to go, but I got left behind by some of the homies. But it's okay.
It worked out for you
for sure, for sure. But dude, that was those times were, man. I mean, it was filmed at the Pink Motel. It was just like really legendary show, and it was very short lived. It was you know. But dude, it stands out for me, and obviously for Chris too. Like, you know,
it was skating like the pool, basically, or what?
No, it was kind of like that. That came with it, but it also gives like whoever was there, it would break down. Like, they would talk to them, and you know, it was like kind of like an insight on those skaters. So it was. Yeah.
And what
so
channel had, was this on?
It was on Nickelodeon.
Oh, Nickelodeon.
And I was too dumb of a kid to know that it aired at this time on these days, and to make it my beeswax to be there. I would just show up and it would be on. And I'd be like, oh my God, lucky day. Look at this.
Right.
And what they had was, they had two hosts. They had one was Skate Master Tate.
Yes.
And the other one was Matthew Lillard from Scream. Matthew Lillard.
He was a skater then too.
And so he was the other host. And they would do different segments. Sometimes they'd be skating the pool as they did like a little bio where Skate Master Tate would, or Matthew Lillard would be talking over top of him about, you know, where this guy's from and what he skates for and like all that stuff. Right. And they also had an interview section with the guy, and they had a mini ramp there. And you mentioned Guy Mariano. Mm-hmm. That's the episode I have taped.
That's the one that stands out to me.
Ninja Turtles. Skate TV with Guy Mariano.
That's so tight.
And then more Ninja Turtles.
Oh my God, dude. That brings me so much memories right there, bro. Jesus.
That's funny. Yeah. And then they would also put in clips from new videos and call out the video, and it would be, you know, Ray Barbie doing like this rad nose pick trick that I still do to this day because of it. And Tom Knox doing this rad like half cab up a bench, it was sick. It was really sick.
It almost seemed like it was like little inserts from like videos that were out at that time, like it had been public domain or whatever, the current Santa Cruz video, but maybe not. It might
that's exactly what it was.
Yeah.
And they would just highlight it, and you know, as a kid you see ramps different, you see everything different, and you're seeing these little backyard ramps that you know, at Eric Sanderson's house, he has this massive vert ramp with a spine on it, and you're like, damn, this dude's got the Skater Die video game, the Skater Die 2 vert ramp in his backyard.
Dude, yeah, but when you say that, dude, I remember skating some, fuck, I think it was a Silmar ramp in the valley, and it was just as, like you were saying, it had, like, you know, multiple different spines, and it was like they utilized the whole backyard and fucking made like a damn skate park ramp, and it was amazing. Yeah. And I always wanted to go there, and I got to go there one time, but like it always stood out like, fuck, that they really made like a beautiful, cool thing for kids or whoever wanted to skate at that time.
Huh. Wow.
Yeah, and when you're that age too, you're in the skate park. You're in it.
Yeah.
You know? I, like as a grown up, even when things are big, you kind of look down on them. You see them from a grown up standpoint.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And when you're a kid, you're inside the park. Yeah. You're down in the bottom of the fun ramp, zone, bro. You're looking up and dude, it's rad. Yeah. It's like a huge bounce house.
Yeah. Truly.
It's true.
Yeah. That's a perfect way to explain it right there for a kid that doesn't skate, and it's just like it's a fucking beautiful bounce house. Oh, I could just go in there.
You know how many skate parks I've looked down on.
No, it's cool. Yeah. When you're
not even there.
I'm just saying, like,
when you were saying that, Chris, looking at both you and Dubs is like emotion. Oh my God. Like you're, that was like one of the coolest things I've ever seen.
Yeah, I mean, I morphed back right there. Yeah. Like, I just fuck, man.
That memory, a time machine.
Yeah. That memory is so strong, and it's especially in my mind. Like
that's cool. Yeah, that's cool that Chris was watching it, and then Dubs was like, you were watching it too, but you got to actually skate the place.
You were kind of there.
Yeah, but it was rare though. And then I actually came across it on TV, like how you were saying, Chris. Like, what the fuck? This is on right now. Like, sick. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, I'm lucky today.
Yeah,
shit.
Yeah, that's so rad.
And this is a time period too when skating was hard to find. It wasn't accessible. Mm-hmm. There wasn't the internet. Yeah. Like, let's start off with that.
Yeah,
right. Internet didn't exist. Okay. So after that,
long before,
it's like skateboarding, you would buy a movie that had skateboarding. You would buy Police Academy.
Yeah, bro. I was just going to say that, dude. The nostalgia from that. Yeah. Part fucking, I think three or maybe three or five, one of those. But yeah,
three or five. Yeah. And like Gleaming the Cube was on repeat at my house just because they had skateboards, and there was like, there were like Rodney Mullen ripped in it. And like, it was like, that was good shit.
Right.
And you didn't get it much. And so if you got it, you didn't care if it was the Goofy movie and it was a cartoon skating or what, if it was Kid Vid from the Burger King Kids Club, if he skated, I'm with it. That's cool. Sure.
That's incredible, man. Now it's just at the touch of a fingertip, man.
Could find it all.
Find it all.
There's too much.
It's too much.
I go through Instagram and I barely look.
Yeah.
I'm just like, ugh.
I'm going home to YouTube Skate TV. Real shit. See? I'm going to check it out just to see. Like, now I have to really, like, go full circle.
And it's probably going
to
be all, like, grainy and bad. Yeah, for sure.
I hope it's uploaded on there.
It definitely is.
It is. All episodes.
I need to watch it, too. That's rad.
Dub's about to go back
do a little... Bring back some history.
Go down a little rabbit hole tonight.
They had really cool segments, too. The segments were Lance Mountain showing you how to grip a board, right? There was like this tools and whatever. And the way that they transitioned was such a good, like MTV sports sort of way. Mm-hmm. And they also had safety tips, and it'd be like Ray Barbie, like, here's Ray Barbie with a safety tip. Watch out for rocks and cracks, you know?
That's it.
And it was just, you got to see your dude just, even if he's saying, you know, watch out for rocks and cracks, you're like, that's the dude.
Well, you never, back then, you never see that. No. You never see these guys even say one word.
Totally. Yeah. And that's, and I liked that. I liked the little aspects of, like, it wasn't just skating. It was also all this other stuff that I could fan out on because these were heroes.
Right.
Just like when you watch the 411 Europe videos, Europe 95, 96.
Yeah.
Those videos are bananas. They're so good, but they also blended a nice little mesh of other things. You'd see Bill Weiss getting his haircut. You know, which I was like, even as a kid, I was like, why the fuck are we watching this dude get his haircut? But it was still like, it was a skater's lifestyle. This dude's getting his haircut. And then they have like Jamie Thomas and Drake Jones talking outside of Radlands. And you kind of put yourself in that, because I never got to go to Radlands. And the idea of going and hanging out in the parking lot of this skate park that's legendary in England, and those dudes are hanging out in the parking lot too. Like, dude,
that's like
dream come true.
That's some of Tom Penny's most epic footage too. Comes from those contests as well.
Oh yeah,
totally.
For sure.
Yeah, which is
totally.
Yeah, he has a lot of great footage, but I feel like that's the most referenced stuff.
Oh, you see him like float over pyramids, front
someone
side
who
flips
stood out and, really much, like Carl Shipman at that time too. Like he was like one of those guys putting shit down at that time. Yeah.
Dude, do you remember Carl Shipman's front blunt in stereo video?
Yeah.
It was at Radlands and it was like the pyramid with the flat bar on it. And he front blunts and the photo of it is insane. Mm-hmm. And the footage of it, like dude, he seriously got like his front knee on the nose.
It's so
cranked.
Damn, sounds familiar.
I emulated one of his photos when we were in England last at South Bank and did an inward heel flip on the bank because I remember that inward heel flip photo at South Bank. Carl Shipman is such a good photo.
Did somebody shoot that photo of you?
Yeah, Andrew Cannon did.
Did it turn out kind of the same?
Yes.
Yeah, it was tight.
Fuck yeah.
Wow, memory lane, dude.
I know.
Easy to go down that
lane. I hope like everybody takes this thing to Google too, because I mean there's a lot of footage out there. We don't have a NFL films for skating. We don't have that. Mm-mm. And on video was the closest.
Yeah, right?
Totally.
They were ahead of their time.
Yeah.
Exactly.
There's a lot of very valuable stuff out there that nobody takes the time to kind of look up. Even with the 90s resurgence and like everybody's dressing like 90s, like watch some of those videos, man. They did every trick.
Yeah.
When I did that MBD part, my disclaimer every time I talked to anybody was all these tricks have probably been done in the 90s. Mm-hmm. These are the tricks that I didn't see.
Right.
But they probably got done.
For sure.
Yeah,
for sure.
NBD on Instagram. NBD. You're like, no. It's been go back a few years.
Looking. You got to search a little bit.
Oh, yeah.
It's hard to
yeah.
find that footage, but, you know, sometimes, but it's, yeah.
Look, I just feel like everything's already been done.
It's hard to stake that claim on never been done, you know what I mean? Unless truly you know that shit's never been done.
That's true.
You know?
Totally. Like, Ocean Howell might have done it.
Bro, Ocean Howell.
Straight up.
Fucking legendary, bro. That motherfucker pulled out so many tricks that I was just like, wait, let me rewind this real quick.
Oh yeah,
you know.
Yeah,
like now let me try that.
Well, back to 70 flip whip slide.
Mm-hmm.
Wow,
that's Ocean Howell.
Yeah.
Oh yeah,
concerto in X minor,
bro.
Let's talk about this. We were talking about the thing, Lance Mountain setting up boards. Let's talk about let's talk about your board setup. Let's talk about Chris Cole's board setup. We already know you've got an 8.5, but what else goes into that? Is there any madness? Do you need something a certain way? Let's break this down.
Yeah. Okay. So I flip flop, not anymore, but I used to flip flop between 8.3, I think it's like 8.349, and 8.5. And the zero, it's the same exact shape. Both of those sizes are the same shape from zero.
Mm-hmm.
But during like some of the Move with Money cups and stuff like that, I was skating 8.3, and it was just, I don't really know why, but now I keep it to 8.5 and I ride Thunder Highs, 149s, even though an 8.5, you could go to 151. I find the geometry for the 8.5 works better with a 149 than the 151s. I think if I went up to 8.6, I'd want to go 151s.
You need a little bit of that. What's clear. It called?
It's a little smaller, right?
Yeah, leverage. Smaller truck. Yeah, a little leverage. Yeah. Right.
But oddly enough, you'd imagine that the wider your trucks get, the tighter they will feel, because your board, you just don't have the leverage, right? Like trying to turn a big bolt with a small wrench, you don't have the leverage. But if you have a big long wrench, you've got all this leverage.
True.
But for some reason, I can't, with my 8.5, I can't get the 151s tight enough.
Anytime somebody talks about leverage, I immediately just think of a treflip. because if the trucks are shorter, you're going to get that more, that leverage.
Yeah.
You know, if they're wider, you're not, it's going to be harder to get around. Look at that tray flip. Yeah. Clunky. Yeah. Exactly.
I was going to say board. I forget what I was riding, but I had the wider trucks and I was like, nope. All my flip tricks were just gone. Like it felt like they were gone.
Yeah.
You know, because you definitely need that leverage.
You go down some stairs or some shit, it might help you.
Yeah, but still, I don't know. That's manualing might have helped.
Yeah.
I don't know.
No.
That's why I started riding a bigger board. When I was a kid, I was probably like seriously 14 or something like that. Mm. Maybe, I was probably younger. I was probably like 12. I was skating 7.5s. And there was randomly... the only board that I could get from the skate shop was this Think board and it was 7.75 and it felt crazy and it felt like it was so big, but I landed everything. I was just landing more tricks on it. And I started having to skate bigger boards because when I would skate stairs, I'd catch it on my way up. Mm-hmm. I'd flip my board and I'd be catching it on my way up. And I'm like, this, I need to slow it down. Mm. And so I started skating wider boards to slow down my flips down stuff.
Interesting.
That's why I said that in reference to
that. Oh, okay. Okay. Wow.
So but the wider truck thing for Kelly, your tray flips and stuff like that, it's you're so grounded.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You're really planted on that ground. And so to get that sort of like that right before you do your tricks, you have a little bit of a squirrel out. Everybody does. Yeah. You have like that last second like lean and it doesn't respond the same.
Exactly.
Like but slower. If you jump into a balanced back nose grind, it's tight.
Right.
Big old wide trucks.
Yeah. So
but to tight. Pop it off, you it's just more surface area. Your trucks are on more surface area.
Right. It makes it easier.
Yeah.
So 8.5, what about the, you said Thunder Highs?
149.
Yeah, 149s. I run Bones Hard Bushings in them.
Bones Hard Bushings?
Hards.
And I crank them, dude.
You skate tight trucks?
Yeah, so tight.
Why the tight trucks?
Because I need, there's a couple reasons. Mm-hmm. Some of them are probably savant. Some of them are probably crazy. Okay. Here's my reason.
Let's hear.
One, you get all the responsiveness. You are going to hit the right side of your tail. Whichever side of your tail you want to hit when you do that trick, you will hit that correct side. You're not going to get this like floppy, disgusting, like half-baked tray flip that's just flopping around.
Sure.
Right? Some people are the exception to the rule and they are totally able to rip on loose trucks.
Yep.
I'm not one of them.
No.
The other reason is that it's impossible for me to not get wheel bite coming off of a trick with loose trucks. Mm-hmm. Like if I jump down a gap, you'll just never see footage of me again. Right. I'll just never land anything ever again. Right. And then I have a theory. And this is where the crazy part comes in.
I love theories.
So I feel like when you have looser trucks, you have to tighten your ankles to keep your board steady, right? You just have to keep that tension. That you have to keep that tension
keep it
on.
Tight, yeah.
If you try to land with everything all tightened like that and you roll your ankle over, now your muscle fibers are like this and you rip them.
Right.
And if you're kind of loose in the ankle, it rolls and comes right back.
Interesting.
I'm no doctor, but
I mean, you got to go off of what works for you.
I'd love to hear what other people say about it.
No, but it, I mean, just like on paper, yeah, it makes sense.
Yeah, but I would love to open that debate in your comments or whatever. Because I'd love to hear what people say.
I don't really understand what you mean. Not like I don't.
That if you have loose trucks and your ankles are really tight and you have to really guide that board around, you know, and you sprain your ankle, your ankle's tight and it's really going to rip some shit.
Okay, now I get
it. If it's loose, you roll your ankle and it's loose. Mm-hmm. It's a loose goose.
And it comes back.
Mm-hmm. And it comes, it's just, it's like a rubber band.
I can see that.
Yeah. Okay.
So I totally see that.
And I don't know if that's legit, and somebody may totally be like, you're a fucking idiot.
Yeah.
That's not how that works. I can't believe you said that.
It doesn't matter. Right, it doesn't matter because that works for you.
People can hear.
Yeah, if you think
you
that.
You said it, that, yeah, in a room with air in it. But,
yeah. Yeah, but if you're thinking it in your mind, like Dub says, like you're going to, you know, it's more comforting.
Right. Like the, like those bracelets that everybody was wearing. That,
oh, the balance. Oh, bullshit. Power balance. Yeah.
Oh man. We were running that shit for a minute.
Everyone was. They didn't even question it.
Yeah.
No.
I'm like, I'm going to use this to make me better. I'm putting shit on.
Balance. All I need to do is put on this rubber band.
But here's the thing. We all knew it was bullshit.
Oh yeah,
right. Like
I got free Laker tickets because of them. You know that was tight. There you go.
Hey, Kelly knew the guy.
Fucking here's the. But was it Kai?
Yep, Kai. Yeah, yeah. Kai's so sick. Shout out to Kai. Yeah,
yeah. Well,
like,
shout out to Kai.
What is bullshit though? Because if it makes you feel better, because you have this placebo,
exactly,
and you're
exactly.
like, then it is working.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know,
totally.
Although the thing doesn't do the thing. But your mind does do the thing because it has the thing on it.
Yeah.
It's all mental. It's all mental.
It is. Totally.
That's it.
So it's all mental.
So you got the tight truck. Got your theories on that. 8.5.
Yep.
What size wheels?
52.
52.
And I run wide boys.
You got the, you like the wide ones, huh? Why the wide and not the skinny?
I feel like the skinny is like ice skate blades.
Okay.
And I don't get that traction control. I don't get that like that grounded feeling that we were talking about with the big old fat trucks and the back nose grind. Yep. You kind of get a little bit of that feeling with the wide wheels. Plus they just, I don't know, they just like, they look tough as nails.
Yeah.
They just like look that, cool, yeah. Man.
Just makes your board look solid.
Solid.
Yeah. Like remember when Adrian Lopez had his, it was like his wheels of fortune.
Yeah.
He does that one line. He kickflip back tails that ledge with those big, big fat pig curb chompers on.
Totally. Yeah.
And I swear he's on like seriously 60s or something. They're massive.
Dude, that time like, for sure. Like 58s or something like that for sure.
Yeah. You were like, those are some wheels.
Right. Yeah.
Can't miss those things.
Yeah. So, I mean, and all the other dudes that I skate with, they ride like big boys, like 56s and stuff like that. And I'm like, ugh. That's now we're back in wheel bite zone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know,
what about
I can't jam up that area?
What about grip tape and all that stuff? Just black?
Just black.
No little designs.
You know what though? I'm like, I cut, I usually cut like a little sort of triangle out of my, like where my back toe would be.
Wait a minute.
Like right around there by the holes.
Really?
Yeah. Right by the bolts. That's like, it's just this little marker. I used to like spray paint my boards and do all sorts of stuff like during the hot wax days. And I would completely fill in my grip tape with spray paint. I didn't really realize like my grip wasn't as grippy because I just spray painted something huge over top of it.
Right.
But yeah, I do that little marker and it's, I like geometric shapes and I like them in art and design and furniture and all sorts of stuff. But I also like them, like the little triangle reminds me of the pinstriping on like a Randy Rhodes Flying V guitar.
I don't know what that is.
It's just a cool guitar that's tight. It's just reminds me of it.
So where does it, so you put it on the tail, you're saying below?
Next
no, it's like it's right above your back bolts, not toward the tail, but toward the middle of your board.
Okay,
back toe
centered.
Zone, you know, like no, it's on the edge. That's why I'm saying toe.
Oh,
so if you're looking at a board, nose is up at the sky.
Yeah,
it's on the tail right is down side. At the bottom.
I'm envisioning
right
like right
the,
he's going to put
bottom
his,
bolt
the pocket
over to the side.
That's what I thought at first. Mm-hmm. But so you're saying it's. You can visually see it.
Yeah.
When you're looking down at your feet.
You're not basically. Stepping over it.
Exactly.
Okay, right. Okay.
No.
Right.
No. The only time that my foot would be on it is if I was on a switch heel flip setup.
Gotcha.
Okay. Because you flip the board around and then your heel's
right,
on it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So is there anything that you really, that would, you need your board set up a certain way? Like if you would have a bad day if it wasn't set up a certain way or something was... You
I mean,
need to change.
We all have that. I mean, to an extent, but I think, you know, like we're professionals here. We can skate. We can skate anything. Right. We could.
Yeah.
We don't. We choose not to. We could skate a board with no nose, but we just it's going to ruin our day a bit. And I think that I would not like it, but would be able to deal with it if one of my bolts was missing. I wouldn't like it.
Right.
But three, I could deal with it.
Three bolts.
Not into it.
You're not a fan, but you could deal with it.
But I can deal with it.
Yeah.
Yeah, throw your mental
skinny,
off.
Skinny wheels.
Slightly.
Not a fan.
Not a fan.
I can deal with it. Loose trucks. Whew. I'm going home.
Yeah, that's probably the worst.
Like, not a fan and not going to deal with it.
Not going to work.
Get somebody else's board.
Dude, your trucks, for me especially, if my trucks are off, dude, I'm done, dude.
Like, oh, my God. That trucks are very important, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, super important.
But actually, I wasn't to ask you something, too, because don't you skate your, don't you have double nose or double tail?
Symmetrical?
I did.
Yo, you don't have that anymore.
I don't.
Why?
I don't have it anymore. And I got to tell you, my switch front heels are suffering. Like, for real.
Why don't you go back?
I'm working it through, but Jesus, man. It's like, this is a trick that I've like, you know, I had a little bit of pride with this trick. I've done them.
Hey.
And I like them and they're cool. And I mean, I don't have a Tom Asa switch front heel. But I can switch front heel.
Hey, and real right quick, now fact check, whack. Issue 42, 4-1 opener, switch front heel, Carlsbad gap. Just throwing it out there, so you've been doing it for a minute.
That's true. Yep. Fun fact, that's on a broken board.
Hey.
Yeah.
Did you have to turn?
Most of my tricks back then were on broken boards.
You have to turn your board around?
No, it was because, you know, the uphill landing of Carlsbad, I cracked that tail coming around.
Okay.
And so it's like, I just,
so you still popped it off the cracked tail.
No, I popped it off of the nose because I skated the nose for switch and skated the tail for regs.
Gotcha.
Yeah. But that was the second time we went, we were at ASR and we went after ASR at night and I tried it and I broke my board and I broke everybody else's board that was there. And then we went back during the day and I did it.
Let's talk about the symmetrical board thing because I just started riding a symmetrical board and I find it.
You did.
I love it. I love it, Chris.
You feel cool.
I just, it's one less thing to think about.
I love it.
Yeah, because you're not flipping your board anymore, though.
I mean, I'm not flipping my board but at the same time, I throw it down and I just ride. I'm switch. I'm regular. I'm just whatever.
Oh, no, that's Ishad Ware business, right?
That's what I was going to ask.
Trucks, because you have to, you know.
They break in the same way.
Yeah.
So you're saying to me that you would skate a symmetrical board, but you'd still have it marked the nose and tail?
Okay. So I'm thinking of this right now.
Yeah.
I'm thinking of this off the top of my head.
No, I love it. I love it.
Does your car's back wheels turn too?
It's all wheel drive.
Or do you turn with your front wheels?
Oh, front.
You turn with your front wheels.
Sure.
Right? Your back wheels don't turn.
Yeah. No.
You turn with your front. If just the back turned, it'd be like a forklift. It'd be terrible.
Yes.
But you steer with the front and the back is stable. And the back will follow the front. Mm-hmm. That's how my trucks are. My front truck is looser, like much more loose than my back truck. My back truck is stable and your head sits above your back bolts majority of the time. So I need that to be stable while the other one just directs where I'm going. So Ishad has his trucks just like yours, where they're broken in the same way. Right. He can flip it any which way he wants and just rip.
Yeah.
I can't do that.
So you still need your front truck to be a certain looseness than your back truck. So you still need to do symmetrical board, but you still have that triangle, the front and back.
Absolutely. And the reason why that I did the symmetrical board was because I want to switch flip. I want to switch flip like other people, like really bad. I want to be like good at switch flips and I want to be like responsive with those things. And I feel like I just can't get the right nolly flips and switch flips going. I feel like I just don't lift up that knee high enough to fire it off. Like, like Kelly, you got a good switch flip. Robert's obviously got a good switch flip. Damn stage. Like I can't do it.
Right.
It's just such, it wants to rock it so hard.
But is that has something to do with your board or more like your physical way of doing the trick though?
I'm sure it's the physical way of doing the trick. But I was trying to overcompensate by just like,
it's kind of both. He's like,
well,
have you ever tried it with your tail and not with your nose? Because your tail, your nose is looser.
Yeah. So I've tried them on my, because my tail's also, like my holes are drilled forward, just like an eighth of an inch or quarter of an inch forward.
Oh, interesting.
So the tipping point, the fulcrum point, the tipping point on the nose is harder to hit. So when you try to hit the nose, you really have to lay into it to get it to hit. Almost like having a really steep nose is what it feels like.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And so it does actually affect the way that I switch flip. Mm. But man, I want to switch foot bad.
Yeah, that makes sense. That makes sense of why it would be hard. That's wild.
The modification of your board is pretty real right there.
But like I've done it off of the tail, and it works. It works so good.
Mm-hmm.
But that's gross. Skating the same side for both, like regular and switch. To me, I know it's, if anybody else loves it, you do you. I back it. But you're going to wear out your boards doubly as fast.
That's true.
Yeah.
Dude, I used to skate my board backwards. Actually, I used to only pop off the nose. Always. Never did a trick off the tail.
Those were different times, man. I used to also put my grip tape like crooked so it'd show like a whole bunch of like top of my board.
Yeah.
You know, by the tail or the nose.
Well, that was the East Coast thing.
So we all did stupid shit.
Yeah.
Oh, it's so funny though. But yeah, in your head, like you're saying, it's kind of like the placebo thing we're talking about with the wristband. It's like whatever it's works in your head.
Yeah, it is. It's all in totally. Preference at the end of the day.
I was like, yo, I have to pop off the bigger side. Like, you know, the nose looked bigger.
Yeah.
So I was like, I have, it's the only way.
See, I think also you would be, back then, a symmetrical board would have been like your ideal board.
No, it would have tripped me out because I know I only felt like I needed to pop off that side. I didn't want to touch the other side.
Yeah.
Weird. You know that.
That wasn't the way I was, but I could see how, you know, once you get.
Once you're zoned in on that, that's what I believed. It was like a weird, it was almost like a religion in a weird, like, this is how I believe I should skate.
Right? Yeah.
You know? And really, I don't know.
Well, everyone, you know, Descends Bro still does that.
Descends Bro. Yeah. I heard he does that. I heard Galia Mamalu did that too.
Oh, wow.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
I feel like board shapes were a bit different back then too. Because there was a little while I was riding these in-house blanks. And I skated the nose too.
Well, because back then the boards were so small, like 7.5, 7.6. Mm-hmm. Dude, the girl boards were so tiny.
When
and like
first came out.
Dude, geez. And I was like, how am I supposed to hit this tail on the ground? This thing's tiny.
Yeah.
So that's why I skated it backwards. I remember getting a Sean Sheffy board, two Sean Sheffy boards.
Oh, I had those small, tiny.
Yeah,
tiny. And I'm like, how the fuck did Sean Sheffy ride this thing?
Yeah.
And that's why I rode it backwards. And I stayed that way until I was 27 years old.
So insane.
Yeah.
And now you know what happened with Kelly Hart.
There you go.
Chris Cole.
Yeah, that's where it came from. I mean, I skated a Tony Ferguson board, the one with the girl logo holding with the Canadian flag. And I skated the tail as the tail.
Right.
So it was
kind of normal. And a Javante Turner board too.
So good.
Nice.
Tail as the tail.
And not only were those things so skinny, they were flat.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
No concave when they first came out.
Hella flat.
I kind of wish I still had one of those.
I mean, got them. I'm looking at them today. They're fucking flat.
Yeah.
Where was it going to be? It was so skinny. There's like, you know, like Felipe Gustavo rides a really skinny board, and he couldn't even fit like shoe sponsor stickers. Like you normally take the shoe sponsor sticker next to the truck under the wheel where it won't get like wrecked. It didn't fit.
It just says Adi. The Adi is cut off.
Dude, just the logo wouldn't even fit there, dude. I mean, it's tiny on that
you
side.
You need the mini stick.
Real small. Yeah. Like seriously, like,
what's two stripes?
Like not even iPhone screen wide.
No.
Style.
Chris,
underneath.
This is... I put rails on my board recently, you know, and I was skating a 7.75.
With rails.
they were rails? They were like this close together, yeah, bro. They were like, like, they were like 2 inches apart.
Yeah.
And that's why I stepped my board up to 825 and now I'm on an 8375.
Damn.
Which is a little too big.
You wear it well.
Thank you, bro.
Yeah. Yeah, I would never have guessed that either, to be honest. No. You couldn't like notice it, really.
I didn't notice it.
Yeah.
Well, I try to blend the color of the bottom of the board with the rails.
I try a little bit.
I do the opposite.
You want them to shine.
Yeah, because dude, remember Alfonso Rawls skating at McGill's skate park? There were like a bunch of hips and stuff like that, and he rode just a natural wood blank with black rails.
I mean, that style, that look, for sure.
Wow. Can we just give it up to Alfonso Rawls now and how fucking amazing that dude is?
Yeah.
Still holding on. What a man. Killing it.
What a man.
So that's your board setup. Okay. So nothing too crazy, but, you know, you have your little quirks, your little tight trucks and everything. So, it works.
You know what I did do? I take the shields off of my Swiss, too, but what I did the other day was I put the spacer in.
Oh.
Remember, like, that was all the rage for a second. You'd throw the spacer in, it would like prevent axle slip or whatever. That's stupid. And
Roger goes nuts about that. He's like, dude, that totally helps.
Yeah.
He's like, you have to put the spacer in. It will change the game.
I do one on each side.
He's a believer of the spacer.
No, here's the thing. It makes sense physics wise. Totally makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sponsored, dude. I'm just kidding. But, no, but like seriously, putting the spacer in, it made my wheels sound different.
Yeah.
Oh.
And I was like, what is this? And then I realized, oh my God, the spacer's in. Like that's how much this is like walking to me. Like this is more natural than walking to the point where I'm like, the spacers, that's what the...
You hear a little rattle.
Yeah.
It was like a muting.
Yeah. Oh. It's kind of like, do you pop your shields at all on your bearings?
Hell yeah, I pop my shields. What do you think, I'm a lunatic?
Well, some people are like, yo, I don't pop it. And I definitely do. The noise, the sound of my board.
I like that sound better.
Oh, yeah, it's so good.
It'll change it. Just that, the shields.
Chris, squeaky pivot cup.
Ooh.
What do you do for it?
I hate it.
Oh, okay.
Do you not? do you like a squeaky pivot cup?
No, I mean... I don't really appreciate it. You know, it's like having loud pipes on a motorcycle in your neighborhood. Where you're like, and your neighbor's like, this sucks. Like everybody that skates with you hears you going crack, crack, crack.
Dude, whose board did I step on the other day and it was just squeaky as hell? I was like, whoa, dude.
It could have been like
you can do though.
What can you do?
Oh wait, no, Kelly had something.
Oh, go ahead.
Oh no, I mean I was gonna say if you did step on mine are always squeaky.
Okay.
Yeah, but if it works, it works. I don't care if it's what it sounds like.
A little squeaky's fine. A little squeak, but when it's really
obnoxiously,
that's the time.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'll mention another thing that sucks.
You're like, something's wrong with your board.
Yeah, like, you better fix that.
Well, first, I mean, quick tip for everybody listening. You just go to the key and lock area of Home Depot.
Mm-hmm.
And they have graphite powder, and you like for locks to blow graphite powder into a lock to make your key actually slide in better and stuff. You just open up your truck and graphite powder it.
What?
Dang.
Wait, what do you mean?
But it's
up
against rubber.
You take it out?
Salt bay. You get a little graphite
bay. Yeah, salt bay, a little graphite dust in there.
Into the pivot cup.
Yeah.
So good, dude.
What?
And that.
Somebody
adds enough barrier between the pivot cup and the pivot. Wow.
To eliminate that sound.
Yep.
You
hook you up.
You just broke
it. I'm trying that. I'm going to try that.
We're Home Depot, right?
Yeah, try it out.
I'm going to try it.
I've got all sorts of those tricks.
I love that.
The one that actually crushes me is, and I know you guys know it, when you ride over a crack and you hear that metal cack and you go, oh fuck, dude! There's a hole in my pivot cup. I ripped my pivot cup.
Yeah, because it went straight through. Yeah, yeah.
And it makes that loud like two blocks of metal like cracking together.
Yeah,
it's terrible because you know that your session's about to suck.
Your board's done at the moment. Yeah,
it's done.
What
for sure.
What do you? What trick do you have for that?
Get a new pivot
cup. I was gonna say get a new one. Okay. That sounds about right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Perfect.
I thought you were going to say some other like weird powder.
I know. I was about to be like,
weird powder, like, there's another something at Home Depot. That
the graphite powder, though. I didn't even know that there was a thing to put it in the key. You know, you'd always put a little, maybe a little oil or something. And
that's what I would have been.
Yeah.
Machine grease.
Machine grease
would work, yeah. Too.
Okay. Huh.
Machine grease is better than like oil. Oil's kind of nasty, but machine grease will last like forever. It'll just be in there, just kicking it.
Kicking it.
Well, let me ask you this. New board, old shoes. Old shoes, new board, new shoes, new board. Whatever, you know, what's a combo there?
I mean, everybody knows that new board, old shoes, totally fine. But new shoes, old board, ruthless. That is a bad day.
I would disagree. You're having a rough time.
Why would you disagree?
The shoes are so much thinner now that it's easily
good point.
Like they're not as thick. Back in the day, that would be nuts. They're a lot thinner now, so I feel like it's a lot easier to break in your shoes right away. And I like that.
Yeah.
I like that for me, the flick of a brand new pair of shoes, because they're usually skate suede with mob grip tape. It's good grip tape. It lasts for a long time. It keeps the grip. You know what I mean?
So okay. I thought this whole pitch of bullshit that you were spraying was so that you could sell shoes.
Motherfucker's trying to sell grip tape. I sell both of them, dog.
Yeah,
believe this, dude. Unbelievable.
He's like, nah, dude. New shoes, old boy. Don't waste your money on a board. You got these new shoes, though.
I'm literally think that way, though. I mean, regardless of what it is, like, I mean, unless I'm skating some old pair of shoes, like from back in the day.
But see, that's why these two questions are interesting, you know, because everybody's different, yeah, and you're, you know, I mean, ideal world, yeah. Chris, what would it be like? New shoes, new board. Ideal world. I mean, you're a pro. You get shit
ideal.
For free.
Ideal world. I always have worn out shoes.
Worn ideal out shoes. World, new board.
You know that. You know that. That scene in the beginning of Black Swan when Natalie Portman's like beating up the ballet slippers and like ripping them out and customizing them. That's how I want my shoes. I'll drive over them.
Really?
Break them in. I'll put them. Yeah, behind the back tires. Back out of the driveway.
Microwave was a big thing. Used to be my shoes.
Put them in for 10 seconds. Yeah. Good to go.
Did that work?
That's right.
I never used it, but I see people.
I would try it.
People do that shit all the time.
Yeah. I feel like I see
Nyjah post, for sure.
Post stuff like that.
Yeah, I don't know if it works. But does he? Do it.
Yeah.
See, I never really ran that one. I feel like that would just be hot feet. I just put them to the street. Just beat them up.
There's another placebo effect. You throw them in the microwave. It works.
What do you feel like it molds it to your foot a little better.
Right.
You know,
because
it's soft.
And right.
Like,
and the rubber gets a little soft. Yeah.
But what if my foot was acting the fool at that moment and doing something stupid? Because, you know, like sometimes you'll put in your feet and you'll be like curling your toes dumb and there'll be something wrong. And then now they're broken in that way.
And now they have to stay that way. Yeah.
You could reheat them in the microwave. You could do a little
adjust
reheat.
A
little reheat.
Yeah, I mean, also, like the disclaimer of this is that us talking about new shoes, new board, it's like we get that that's posh. Okay. We're talking first world problems here.
Oh,
yeah.
100%.
But you know, ideally, if we're talking perfect world, I want 3 week old or 2 week, 2 week, 3 week old troopers and a new, like a crispy new board.
Are you talking about 2 or 3 weeks skated every day in them or just kind of, I mean,
walking
in? I'm picturing like.
Who skates every day?
You might.
I know. I don't know.
You might skate every day.
I'm just picturing these beat up holy shoes that you like in a brand new board.
No, man, like shoes hold up, man. Shoes that aren't like vulcanized shoes break down a little bit faster, right?
That's true. That's
we know
true,
that.
Definitely. Yeah.
But cupsole shoes, dude, they last. Man.
Oh, you're a cupsole dude?
They last. Yeah.
A cupsole guy. Okay.
Yeah, by nature, like it's a flick that you can rely on. You know where it's going. I'm a cupsole dude through and through, but I'll take it to some Volk, like rippers after I get that edge worn down.
Got to get the edge.
Once that edge is worn, and I'll take them brand new and just scrape that all over my brand new grip tape and just dig them out.
Yeah. Well, I felt
bring it
like
down a little bit.
I feel like the vulcanized, it has a better flick to it. Like it has more of a flick. Not a consistent flick. Does that make sense?
Totally. It grabs.
Yeah, it grabs so good. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then the cupsole, like you said, it's like something you could easily rely on.
So, you know, when you do a kickflip and it really grabs and it tries to do this front foot backward impossible thing and it cracks you in the knee, right? Mm-hmm. That thing. That's what I get almost always out of a vulcanized sole. And so if I'm trying to do any of like the twirly bird, like back three flips and stuff like that, you know, it's going to be cupsole for sure. I can't put that type of like torsion on a backside flip with some bolt.
Oh, backside flip is the number one.
Ooh.
Gets ringed up in your legs.
Thing holds on for dear life. It's crazy. It's
trying to stick to that thing.
I want like the John Alley kickflip gun.
Ooh.
From Dying to Live, where he was just firing kickflips into everything, and it's the same kickflip each time.
Oh, dude,
textbook.
Speaking of him and what the new generation of that, I feel like it's Chris Weimer with his kickflip.
Right?
Yeah, like it's got like his kickflip is unreal too.
Dude, I saw him do a kickflip tuck knee.
Mm. Damn.
Yeah, down like a five block, and he did it. He did it so easy. He kickflips. He just grabs it indie and just cranks it.
The tuck knees always trip me out.
Little John Thomas.
Kickflip is real. Really? Out,
man. Yeah. Just how do you do that? I can't fathom how to pull that back.
Can you
up.
Japan?
You gotta be stretchy with that one too.
I can do a little backside grab, you know, a little bump or something.
That's tight.
A little method grab.
Yeah.
You know?
A little Japan though, but I can't tweak it. I used to do little Japans. Yeah.
Can't do Mike Carroll style? Okay.
Little
not,
Japan.
Not a Mike Carroll style?
No. Oh my
dude,
gosh.
Dude, Mike Carroll style. It's like, it's like Mike Carroll, Tommy Guerrero. Those are like
Tommy G.
I mean, yeah, it's. But like Mike Carroll, like street dude ripping a Japan like that is. Woo.
Mike's still doing those things.
Real. Oh, yeah,
that's
man.
So sick.
Yeah. Pilates
dude,
helps.
I've never. Oh, dude, I've never done a Japan like that ever in my life. And it probably feels sick.
Oh, my God, I'm sure.
I think anything you roll away from just feels sick.
Well, that goes without being said.
I don't know. Sometimes I've rolled away from tricks and been like, that was stupid.
I mean, it does happen.
I hope nobody saw me.
It does happen. It does happen. It does happen.
I wanted to ask about Fallen, dude, because you've been, now you're back on there. Like, what's like your go-to shoe on Fallen right now?
The Trooper.
Trooper.
It's such a workhorse, man. Like, yeah, I'll run Troopers for days.
Oh, three, 4 weeks old, and that's like your prime? Yeah.
Properly. Like, And then I kick them off and like at a skate spot just to kind of leave them for somebody. But they're not killed.
Right.
Like I'll wear them down to the floor before I get through the side.
Oh wow.
Damn.
Yeah.
Do you throw any insoles in them?
I do. I throw the Remind Medic insole.
Okay.
Thanks for bringing that up, man.
Yeah.
Nice. No, but I do. And the reason why is I like an arch support.
Oh, you
know, like remember
arch.
When like Circa used to put a little arch support in their shoes back in the day. And I would always opt to throw that arch support in there because it was like a little foam, like it's a weird little foam thing. But I need to have that arch support. I like the bottom of my soles to be flat, but I'm not trying to put my arch against the ground.
No.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. For, totally.
It hurts.
Some people have flat feet.
Yeah, that might work for them. But
I got a good arch. Sounds like you got a good arch too, Chris.
I mean, is it good? Is it bad? I don't know, but it needs attention.
It needs some support. Needs support.
Yeah, we need to whip this thing up.
I feel like you're back. I mean, like all these brands, Zero, Fall, like, are you just in like this nostalgic place right now where you're just like, this is so cool?
I've always been nostalgic, which is funny. So it's just kind of like the right time for these things to take hold. And I think that there are a lot of brands and a lot of things that were so special to us that went away.
Yeah.
Like Fallen, where you realize just how awesome they were. And there's a bunch of other brands that like had the same sort of like feel as well, where there was like, you have this feeling of, I love that era. I love that design. Why can't we have that? And it's not around. And so it, like, you know, for years and years, probably the past 10 years, I've had a folder in my phone of just old actions.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Because I was just so into that shoe company as a kid. Like, mm-hmm. I was so into it. The designs were so forward and they were awesome. And like, so I would keep action in this folder with all these things, and I'd keep fallen catalog photos in this folder.
Wow.
So I could look back at all these designs, because I feel like there is a golden year era, like the golden years of skate shoe designs.
Mm-hmm. Totally.
And you can see when people are trying to do them again.
Oh yeah.
And or trying to emulate it, but they don't have the right vision. They're not seeing what made them incredible. They're just going, hey, we need 90s. What's 90s? And they're like, paneling, lots of paneling.
Oh, yeah.
And you're like, that doesn't do it.
Right.
It was the fact that they took black mesh and then black suede. And then they had reflector pieces in the laces. And it was so many bells and whistles, and even ones that were unseen. But they were special.
A lot of it's coming back right now.
Do you see that new, the one that DC did, where there was like the all three shoes in one shoe?
Oh, I seen that. Wasn't Josh skating them the other day? He posted an Instagram clip.
Like no slide popover on
the curb. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They did the Legacy, they did the Lynx, and the Kalis all in one shoe.
Oh, wow.
Which I was like, what? And it looks actually dope. It was just like, I'm not trying to sell it like I'm like, this is a DC ad, but something new that I've never seen before.
Like three in one.
Yeah, it was three in one shoe.
They just took three components and just put them together type deal?
Yeah, but it was like, it was all of them, and you could see all of them. Not like little hits. It was like literally all like stacked on top of each other.
That's interesting.
It was it was something different, and I was like, cool. At least they used their own heritage to do something. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's true.
Thought that was cool.
I mean, you kind of have to utilize it. If like, there's only so many brands that have it.
Yeah.
You know, a heritage.
Yeah. Fallen has the heritage right there.
Totally. And almost like so much of it that you're like, what do we do?
Where do you begin?
What do the fans want? Because we have enough heritage that we don't even have to design shoes ever again.
Yeah.
Like we could just keep doing these.
Right.
But you're like, where is that balance?
Totally. How do you push it forward? How do you push it forward? And how do you keep the nostalgic like current?
Mm-hmm.
It's totally.
Yeah.
I mean, you deal with that. It's tricky.
It's more of a designer thing too. I feel like sometimes designers are like, dude, I want to design my own thing.
Mm. I mean, but look at what Vans has done.
Totally.
You know?
I mean,
they have like what, five silhouettes or that just are stable.
But also have their staples they can rely on, and they're also trying to push it forward.
I see that, but sometimes that does not work.
Exactly.
Well, like, I hear what you're saying.
I
had this conversation with my best friend PV, who is a furniture designer and maker. And we were talking about this where, you know, a Windsor chair is this classic chair. If you saw it, you'd know it.
Okay.
Whether you know furniture or not, you'd be like, oh yeah, that chair. Yeah, everybody had that chair. That's an amazing chair. That's a Vans era, right?
Mm-hmm.
They're going to sell that it's basic, it's classy, and they can sell it for 100 years.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because it's just beautiful. Yeah. It's timeless.
And it's reasonably priced, right? It's like
the encompass of everything, I would imagine.
Yeah, it's like what, $60? Yeah. I want to say. So, I could be wrong, but I don't know.
Yeah, I didn't check the price sheet lately, but I imagine that it's like, I imagine it's pretty affordable because it's like two panels.
Yeah, totally.
Soul. And it's just like this is what a human foot should be encased in. This is the pants.
Oh, there you are. We thought what you just cut out on that last part. What was that last part you just said?
That's good because
it doesn't.
Didn't say anything.
But you're saying about the Windsor chair?
It basically, it's just a classic. It's forever.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how you know, sometimes less is more.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
You don't need more. You don't need to reinvent something when you have such a good design.
Exactly.
That's true. Man, Chris Cole, bro. Look at you.
What? I mean, check me out.
Look at you. Look at you. Yes.
Oh, hey, what's, you got the CBD thing you've been plugging a lot too. What's up with the CBD thing?
Yeah, it's a CBD thing. CBD MD.
CBD MD.
They have a ton of different products, and whether it's roll on, like the Freeze, which is my favorite one. That's the one that I use, because you can use the rolling applicator as like kind of like a massage to like kind of press it into whatever you're massaging it into. For me, it's usually like an ankle or like the side of my knee. Mm-hmm. Like my IT bands are all tight.
Oh, wow.
So like right on the side of my knee, it gets like really sore right there. And then there's also products like a nighttime drop. So you can do that. There's gummies that I actually really like that help with like anxiety and things like that. And it's like a better mood and more like calm and relaxed.
I back CBD, bro. Real talk.
Like, dude, I back it too.
I used to be like the placebo effect type deal, but this shit works, really.
Well, I think some brands are better than others.
That goes without being said,
right,
for sure.
Right.
I agree.
Yeah.
And the ones that work, definitely, you know, obviously use those more than you would the ones that don't work.
right. Totally. Right. Yeah. This one doesn't work, but you know what? I like it.
Yeah. You know, it's cool too when you give somebody the heads up. Like, you know, I skate for this stuff, but then people will hit me up and be like, hey, you know, like I have this problem. Do you think this will help? Mm-hmm. And then I actually get an opportunity to help somebody.
Yeah.
You know, wow. Be like, yes, you should use this one. Yeah. And this is when I use it, which would actually like benefit for what you need it for.
Yep.
And then they'll message back and they'll be like, dude, thank you so much. Like, this is great.
Oh, wow.
And then I get all those feels because I help somebody out and like they're happy and I'm happy.
Yeah.
Like it's a feel good situation. Plus it's, I don't know. Like I like that there's so many different things. They have like bath bombs and stuff. Like you want to get romantic with yourself and hang out in a CBD bath
and feel good.
Light a candle, like maybe watch some Netflix.
That's good. That's amazing. Cause I feel like I've tried different CBDs and I just don't notice. And it's like taking a vitamin. Like, does it really help? I don't know.
It's interesting. You know, there's different types you can take that would help certain different things. Right.
Yeah.
Cause I mean
totally. The sleep tincture definitely works for me. I've definitely taken a little sleep tincture and I'm like, fuck, that worked. And I sleep like clear. I don't wake up like groggy or anything. I'm like, all right.
Yeah.
Not mad at that.
Dude. And that's, I mean, dude, talk about an important situation. Sleep.
Yeah.
Like to get restful sleep, like real, like, I mean, you're a high functioning individual, dude.
Mm-hmm.
You deserve nothing less. That's like your sponsor sending you like the cheap shit, you know, and you're like, I'm supposed to be like doing this for real. Like, give me the shit, right? So you go to sleep. You go to sleep and they pass you some like broken bearings.
Yeah, you know, dude.
Like, no, man, I need to function.
Well, give me some shit that works.
Send me ABAC ones.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I need those ABACs. I need those Swiss.
What would you recommend if I put, what would I, if I have hip and ankle issues, like what would you recommend for that, for bath CBD? Bomb.
I would do the cream for the hip, and then I would do, the Freeze for the ankle. Cause the reason why I say that is because I use the Freeze on my ankle a bunch because I've broken my feet and not gotten them fixed. And so there's like extra bone and stuff like that. And it grinds and it's like pretty, it's pretty painful in certain situations, right? Like I can outside roll my ankle, you know, like sit on it. And it hurts super bad. So I run the CBD for that. And what I usually use it for too is for your ankle and hip is I'll run it before the session so that like I can kind of like I put it on, then I start stretching, then I go skate.
Yeah, it's interesting, man. I've tried CBD. It's just never worked. And that's why I said some brands just aren't this good.
Yeah.
You just get some bunk shit.
Well, it's the gold rush right now.
That's true.
Right?
Yeah.
That's true.
Like this is like the 49ers. It's like the floodgates opened and everybody's rushing in.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I'll get a little CBD yeah. thing and it's like 90% menthol. Mm. And I'm like, menthol? What is this? Like, I'm going to CBD.
What are you trying to sell me here?
Trying to get CBD'd up.
So yeah. It's CBD MD. That's what it is.
Yeah.
I'll have to try
that's
some.
That's what it is.
Try some.
Yeah.
Maybe cool. A nice little bath yeah. bomb. Ooh. Little ankle freeze.
Hey, man. You deserve it.
Thank you,
bro. Yeah, definitely.
Maybe they can send a little care package.
Hey.
Yeah. Hey, Jeron. Hey. Welcome. That's Jeron
hey.
For you.
Hey. I'm not mad at trying out some see? Care package yeah. stuff.
That's right.
That's what's up.
That's a like legend that. Right there. When he wants a care package, you get him a care package.
Jeron fits right in here.
Fits right in. Oh, gosh. I don't mean to ask man. For things, but I mean, no. We're talking about stuff that works here.
It was either you or me, Dubs. Yeah. It was either you or me. Glad it was
totally.
You. Listen, dude, we loved chatting with you, bro. Very, very fun to so talk fun. To, dude. And the Zero thing and Fallen and CBDMD and Remind Insoles and what else we got?
Dude, what was the thing? The trick CBD. Tip thing. What was the
Stomp Sessions?
Stomp Sessions. That's right.
We're plugging shit.
Yeah, that's what we're here to do.
It's the plug time.
This is
time.
Yeah, this is the plug session of the show.
Nice.
He's got a few other ones you can plug too, Chris. Come on. Don't be bashful. Let's not be bashful now.
I got knives.
Oh, the knives. Yes, dude.
I got knives.
Hey, there it is.
I'm glad you're over the internet right now, man. Pop that knife out.
Wait, what's the name of the knife company again?
Kershaw.
That's it.
I just etched some rose into it right now.
Turn it a little side, little sideways.
Where are we going to find the light? Where are we going to find the light?
Are they a little bit?
There you go.
I see the silhouette of it.
No.
There it is.
What do you mean you etched that?
Yeah, there's a, I go to this wood shop and like have a little something to do with this wood shop and it's called Soil and I go there all the time and I build furniture because nice. I like to and we have a laser cutter and I've been learning how to use the laser cutter and cutting stuff.
Got you. I thought you were talking about
so
you hand because I've seen those people who do those hand etching on different knives.
Can't and, do it and like skills. Them.
Well, they do it with guns as well, like really fine, intricate etchings and all this stuff I've seen on the internet.
Yeah, I don't have any guns, but I have a lot of knives.
Yeah.
Because... Knives? I don't want to open. I can't open up packages with a gun.
Right. You could.
That's not a good
grip
idea.
Grip a board with a gun.
You shoot the damn thing.
You can't. No, well, you could.
You could. There's always the right tool for the right job, right?
There it is.
This is true. I love it, man. Yeah. You got a lot of things going on. And then you got your family. Yeah. Everybody's good over there. You go skate with your kid a lot?
I do.
Amazing.
I do.
It's now, like, do you teach him tricks? Or does he not? I'm wondering what the age is. Like, you know, you're Chris Cole. You're a legend. You're professional.
I'm dad.
That's what I'm saying, though. How, when does that come in where he's like, Dad, you don't know how to do that shit. Let me do this stuff.
I doubt he says that.
Well, you know what I mean, though. It's like they want to do it themselves and not get dad's advice.
I totally get that. And, you know, I think that's the problem with every parent. I mean, this is the only thing I can teach you. The only thing,
dude.
I totally can teach you how to do it.
Like, right,
I can save you so much time. But it's like, what do you know? You know,
what do you know?
Or like, I mean, he doesn't do this anymore. He actually listens to me now. But back when he was younger, he would say like, that doesn't work, and I'm like, it definitely works. Promise.
Yes.
My kid at five years old, he says, I'm going to do it on my own. Okay.
Okay.
Sick. No, but this is how you do it. No, I'm going to do it on my own.
Right.
Okay. You do it on your own. Let me know how that goes. And if it happens, then
great. Sometimes they got to learn on their own, you know? Yes, hey, that stove is hot. Don't touch that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, sometimes they got to touch it to realize it is hot. It's hot.
Well, those are the things when, like, when you do intervene, when your kid has, like, when your kid's itty bitty, their neck is like that big. Mm. They've got, like, their head is like humongous. It's like sitting on top of this little tiny neck, and they want to drop it on a vert ramp. Oh, and you're God. Like, calm down. you are going to rip that head off of your neck.
You're a little top heavy right now.
That's how I feel right now.
Yeah, actually. Like you do not have the neck muscle to hold your brain from smacking on the ground. Yeah. You need to pump the brakes on that speed. I'm going to tighten those wheels down.
That's going to help.
So he listens to you now. He's taking all taking all your advice on foot placement and popping and pockets and all that stuff.
Totally.
Cool.
He's got it. It's just not like his treasure. He likes to do it because it's fun and he likes to skate with his friends and stuff like that, skate with me. But it's not the treasure that he's like, I'm trying to get sponsored.
Oh,
it's
he's not that. At okay. All.
No, not at all. It's not what he's going to do.
At least he likes it though. That's which is totally really cool.
And that's rad because it's such it's a father son thing. Yeah. The bond.
For sure. I'm waiting for that.
Absolutely. I mean, there are things that you can do as a parent that you try to find. You try to find those things in relationships and you try to find those things in parenting. And when you have a boy and a girl who are very, very different and very into different things, you have to juggle that and you have to find what can I do with both of them and try to figure out to navigate that so that you have these shared experience and this fun and this bonding moment. It's really, really tricky. And then something like skateboarding
and you're
just like drops in your lap and you're like, oh my God, this is turnkey. This is easy. And I'm happy.
Yeah. I mean, if he got into fencing or something, you'd be like, I don't know anything about fencing. Like you can't bond. How are you going to buy?
Except, I mean, that's really cool. I mean, that would be something.
I'm just saying,
let's fence.
Right.
You'd be going together.
Let's go to Big Five or get in the mask and little pointy stick.
Now we're fighting.
Hey, who's your son's or some of your son's favorite skaters?
I have no idea.
Or does he have any favorite skaters?
I don't know. Does he watch your video parts? Does he know about your what you got going on?
He's 14.
On?
He has to.
Yeah,
know.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
But I do remember the first time. I don't remember what it was, but I remember the first time that he had information that I didn't show him. That we didn't show him, and he had information on his own. And it was so weird. It was such a trip that this up until that point. This thing was I was guiding to this is what a dog is, and then this is what a door is, this music is that, and then he found information on his own and I was like, oh my God, he's loose.
That's rad.
That's a trip.
He's growing up.
Yeah, it's very weird.
Hey, well, maybe it'll turn into something, maybe it won't, you know, but like you said, like as long as he's having fun, that's the main thing.
That's right. Yeah. Dude, I like that you guys got the Why So Sad board up there.
The what?
The Why So Sad board. It's not up there. It's fine.
Oh,
over there.
Yeah.
Yeah, we try to get little things over here, you know?
Yeah, Raj does the background a lot. Lovely.
Fuck yeah. Yeah, he just changes it up.
Zero board.
You know? You got guns on Zero still, dude? Tommy Sandoval, man.
Dude, did you see Tommy Guns try to bunny hop on Dane's bike over those boards? Did you see that footage?
No, I missed it.
Holy shit.
Well, I think I did. Did he get smoked?
Oh, he got so smoked. he doesn't know how to bunny hop, right? We teach him how to bunny hop. A hop, not a bunny hop. We teach him how to hop, right? In the parking lot. And he learns at that moment. And then he wants to start hopping over boards. No. So we start stacking boards. And he's like, more boards. And we're just like, this is kind of crazy. This dude can hop, and he just learned, right now. And he's hopping pretty high. But just like with skating, you don't know what's going to
transpire.
When it goes sour, you don't know.
Yeah.
You don't know when it goes sour because you haven't had all those experiences. So he hit five boards.
Five?
Right? And he hits it with his front tire. Oh my God. And I have a still frame of him. With his hands still on the grips. And he's a foot and a half from the ground. Like his hands are like a foot and a half from the ground. And he's completely over the bars, head facing the ground, hands engaged on bars.
Like it happened that fast.
Take your hands off bars.
Yeah.
Yeah, I did not bail until the last possible moment, and he used his head as a hand.
Oh my goodness. Did he try to go for it again?
No. Normally he does. He actually, dude, he nollie flipped the Atlanta four block.
Damn.
You know, the, like, big Atlanta four block, mm-hmm. right? He nollie flipped that thing, and he tried it like 30 goes, and he landed primo one go off of that so hard. In like a pair of Chiefs, like vulcanized shoes, so hard that he eats shit. Board stays in primo.
Oh, wow.
Like the board was so solid that it stayed there.
Oh,
and, he continued to try it until he made the trick.
Jeez,
I don't want to be this dude, but this is something as a kid you would say. But like, didn't Beeble do that?
Nollie flip down those?
Yeah,
I'm pretty sure.
Fully flared.
Yeah.
Cause it goes, it has a Jeezy song, Young Jeezy, and he's like, in the ATL, and it fucking shows the nollie flip down it.
Oh, okay. Well, this was like 100 years before that, so I'm just saying.
I thought this was recent. I was like, oh, shit, okay.
I mean, Chris, you were talking to a guy that knows every single 411 profile.
But he didn't know that.
No, I knew it, but I didn't know that he had tried that, because I would never know.
Okay.
Because
yeah, I also think that like Lord knows if the footage ever got used.
Exactly. You know? Oh, yeah.
Zero camp is. Sometimes there we don't use good footage.
There you go.
I know, right? You guys probably have some leftover footage in the older videos.
Should start putting this stuff out.
I put like a 15-minute footage tape together, and none of it got used.
No.
What?
Way.
Yeah.
Where is it? What are we doing?
Lord knows. But it's definitely like.
Can you find
it? I shot 30 photos with Ryan G that never got used.
What the fuck?
And then like a 15-minute footy tape that never got used.
That's like four pros' careers right there combined.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, long edits.
I'm just saying 30 photos.
Not
like
tight.
Hey, 15 minutes? That's like.
Yeah, this isn't like misled youth.
Right.
Let's break it down. All right, like 9 minutes.
Yeah.
9 minutes cut tight. That's fucking still fucking amazing. That didn't get used.
I know. That's a heartbreaker when you're like, wait, you didn't like the filming? Fuck.
Yeah.
Well, me and Chris are just saying right now, and I think Kelly would be like, this is the perfect time for that stuff to come out.
Oh my God.
You get that footage and you put it out the way you want to put it out.
There you go.
Hell yeah.
Oh, that'd be fun.
Finally use those songs you want to use.
Oh yeah, the Debbie.
Like
what was
WAP. I'll use WAP.
What's WAP? Oh.
Jesus.
That's a good Chris Cole skating out, to like WAP. Here. Yeah.
Totally. We're fucking totally trying to stay up with the times right now. Check this shit out.
Yeah. How you like me now?
Holy shit. You're the best.
That
bro.
Would be amazing. No, but you can bring out Debbie Gibson. Put Debbie Gibson on that shit. Exactly. Bring it back.
Let's go.
I think this is a great time for her too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know?
I'm not mad at that.
Like with the way COVID shutting down venues.
Chris Cole part, I'm sure she'd be hyped too.
Debbie Gibson.
You know what would be neat? Yeah. If you could create some sort of choose your own adventure. Like you get to pick which song the dude skates to, right? Like in the menu drop box, and you like you look through them, and there's like three different edits, and you click on them. Which
and it's
one you edit want.
Perfect for
and
it.
Yeah, the beats and everything. It's
wow.
There's another idea.
Damn, that's kind of a good idea.
I mean, I think that there's the a lot more involvement in there that I don't know how
it
works.
Imagine if you put like in the clips, you individually would put like certain points where you could land a beat on. And then in this app, it calculated that.
Yeah, like a help you along.
You put the song within it.
Yeah, you're putting a tag.
Yes, exactly. Tag. And it synced up with those tags.
Yeah.
There amazing. We go.
That'd be amazing.
Man, Kelly just complicated this thing a lot, bro.
Someone could do it out there. Someone could do that.
I think we just made one of your listeners a proper amount of money.
If they put the work in for it, send us,
Listen, man,
they're already on it. Don't say it. They're on it.
I appreciate it. Yeah.
Just send Chris Cole a check.
Say that you got the idea from us.
Yeah.
That's all it is.
There you go. There you go. Well, listen, man, we don't want to take up more of your time, bro. This has been incredible.
This has been awesome.
Yeah, Chris Cole. It's been a good time. Dude, seriously, congratulations on everything.
Yep.
Super stoked for you,
man. Thank you, dude.
Definitely.
And can't wait to see the next moves, you know, next trick moves. Let's go.
All right. Well, I'll try to make them cool.
Oh, yeah, you always do.
Anything you do, bro.
I love being here. Thank you so much for thinking of me and having me on. And I just right now realized that you have a mic set up toward the TV as if I'm there.
Yeah.
Like, I didn't get that this entire time until this second.
Look, we it's funny. We were going to put a drink there, but we didn't know if you had a drink sponsor or not. So we were going to put a little beverage there.
Should I face the mic?
You can face. Yeah.
There it is.
Totally.